Recording.
All right. According to my computer, we are actually live. So welcome to anybody that might be watching this. This is the What Do I Know About Actual Play series of videos. We are currently playing Shadow of the Demon Lord. This is our third session. Everyone is second level. This podcast is sort of associated with my What Do I Know Games and Geekdom blog. My name's Jared Rasher. I talk about a lot of things. None of it's really, you know, that important, but it's me. So, currently, we're going to be playing this game for 11 sessions, which is a full campaign in this game system. And I'm going to jump straight into the introductions. And first off, my show notes say to introduce Ryan and ask him who he's playing. Hey, Ryan, who are you playing?
I'm Ryan. I was playing Teapot. Teapot actually attuned to the book that he found in the first session, which, among other things, made it so he learned 3 demonology spells, which put me at 11 corruption all by itself, which caused him to become an NPC. So I am playing Sir Not Appearing in most of this episode while I come up with another one, because we discovered this about 5, maybe 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, we added up his corruption score, and I looked at it, and I was like, oh, I have bad news for you. I killed you between sessions.
But that's okay. This I'm not surprised, and Teapot probably deserved it.
This is a feature, not a bug, of the game system. You can give people enough rope to hang themselves with. So Teapot exploded in a blast of infernal void energy and is no longer appearing as part of the party. So for my next introduction, slightly happier, Steve.
Hi. I am playing Abigail Tuller, our resident witch, heal bot and prostitute, so kind of running around healing everybody in body and mind.
All right. And with that, we will go to Mr. Hobbs. Why don't you introduce yourself and tell people where they can find you on the internet and who you're playing?
All right, I'm Jason Hobbs. I'm one of the masterminds behind Hobbs and Friends of the OSR, if you want to call it that. You can find me on Twitter at Hobbs Indeed, or email at Hobbs and Friends at Misdirected Mark Podcasts. Or I don't even know what it is, obviously. I never use it, so don't bother. Or just Jason Hobbs on G+. I'm playing Kane Smythe, young one-time saboteur, novice, or acolyte of the new cult of the new god, and lately a warrior and guard visited by angels.
All right. Mike, why don't you tell us where people can find you on the internet and who you're playing?
People can find me at mikemeiler.com. They can also find lots and lots of free stuff there. And I update it with more free stuff every week. It's great. Specifically about Pathfinder and D&D, although I'm starting to branch out and shout out the people more. I'm playing Fringe, an amnesiatic psychopath changeling. And I feel like that really just sums everything up about her.
Yeah, much like some of our other, party members, Fringe is kind of
she's not corrupted. She's not corrupted. She is 2 points insane, but she can get rid of that with corruption, from what I understand.
So. All right, and finally, we'll throw this over to Kevin. Why don't you tell people where they can find you on the internet and who you are playing?
Sure. Hi, I'm Kevin Madison. I can be found on the Dungeon Musings YouTube channel and the Dungeon Musings blog. I don't really stay active on the blog anymore, but there's lots of 5th edition D&D stuff that can be found on there. And I'm playing tonight, or today, Vigdis Magnusson, a Jotun warrior, former bouncer at a brothel.
All right.
Truly the most. Yes. And, the most heroic of startings. So
yeah, and also as we found out, like in the pre-show, apparently the most trusted member of the of the party.
and at some point, if he backstabs us all, we all deserve it.
If he backstabs you, it'll be somewhere in the range of the back of the head, I think, from the height difference.
The height and our head will be somewhere, you know, 7 blocks away.
Yeah.
Sorry for dropping out there. My internet connection decided to get dicey for a moment.
That's okay. For a minute, you were showing up twice, so I just thought you were playing 2 characters.
Well, you know, having 2 of Abby would be kind of terrifying.
All right. So for our really quick recap of what's happened so far in this campaign, in case anyone's watching these videos and hasn't watched the other 2 videos, which shame on you if you're doing that. Don't do that. Go back and watch them. But if you don't want to. they started out, the adventurers started in a town that was destroyed by cultists, and they eliminated a magical blot underneath the town. A year later, all of them moved to the big city, and Mother Bastion, who they also met in that town, hired them again to dig up dirt on the bishop. And this particular session is taking place about a month after that event. And we're going to go through where everyone's starting location is. And Teapot's, what's left of Teapot is screaming in the void. That was easy. Okay. Vigdis, according to your downtime role, you have been gainfully employed and you automatically get the getting by lifestyle.
Nice.
Whatever you would, you automatically get getting by. You don't need to pay for your lifestyle. But what kind of jobs have you been doing?
I think I want to hear what Abby's been doing first, and then I'll sort of figure out from there. Well, Abby and Kane I've been doing, and I'll probably been bouncing back and forth between that, whatever they're doing.
We'll bounce over to Abigail then. Abigail, your downtime event is you gambled with some nobles.
Oh, lovely.
You managed to win 4 gold coins from them.
Oh, wow. So Vigdis got paid by me apparently. And I've been paying him to run around the tent city with me.
So now, Abigail, what lifestyle would you like to pay for? Because you do not automatically get a lifestyle with your downtime event.
Actually I am going to go with I don't really want to be extravagant. The one that's right above getting by that you can invest in, but not rich, that one.
Oh, so you want to be comfortable?
Yeah, I'd like to be comfortable.
So comfortable costs you 2 silver.
All right. Well, I've got gold now, so I'm like, wait a minute.
Yeah, and you make me an intellect challenge roll with 1 bane.
All right, intellect challenge roll with 1 bane. All right, red die and black and white bane die. Well, that wasn't very good. 3. Okay. 7 minus 4.
You didn't manage to save up anything extra. You just lived comfortably for the last month.
That was that's a nice change of pace over the past year.
Indeed. So now, knowing that Abby, she's been going into the tent city, ministering to the poor, she's been rolling some nobles and gambling. So what has Vigdis been doing?
Vigdis, yeah.
Oh, so Vigdis, yeah. No, so he, I think, has probably just been lurking along. I'm not sure he understood what was going on at that noble thing. Lots of fancy people who give Abby money, and that's sort of what he's used to anyway.
For completely different reasons, but yes.
Yeah. So I think he's just been sort of going along, and I think that eventually Vigdis is going to go towards the Scald master path, but so I'm not sure if there was, like, Jotun really aren't from here. In whatever downtime he was, he might start trying to, like, explore that, or if there's some sort of story reason why that comes into his life.
Okay.
Well, but I'm not sure what that would necessarily be just yet. But
well, the Tent City is where a lot of refugees from the Empire collapsing have ended up in. So you could talk to a wide variety of people from all over the continent in this, you know.
Okay, cool.
So yeah, you could just be collecting stories from lots of people while you're, you know, while you're keeping an eye on Abby as she walks through the tent.
Yeah. So what I think it might be then is because he's a thrall, he's sort of he's doing this warrior thing right now, but I think that it's at best his like imitation of what he thinks it should be. It just so happens that everyone else is smaller and weaker than him, so he's really effective at smashing shit, but he hasn't had that lifetime of training that a lot of the other Jotun warriors would have had. So maybe there's someone there who sees him, like, you know, armor off, you know, not on the right way fitting. Yeah. And is like, hey, come here, idiot. Don't you know about...
No way. This way. This one.
Yeah. So maybe he's informed a little bit more by someone who's more in the know. That could be like a human or a Jotun or whatever.
Okay.
Or even an orc for that matter, I guess. I mean, there could be conceivably be an orc scholar.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, orcs share a sort of common ancestry. Now, Jotun from their native region don't particularly like orcs, but that doesn't keep you from, you know, picking up on some orc habits.
No, you know what? I mean, if you want, Jared, you can take it or leave it, but this could be an agitator for the orc king as well, too, who's trying to, like... Why would you serve these lesser people? They've enslaved us both forever, you know?
Awesome. Yay. More GM things.
Yeah. So I think that's what he's been up to.
Okay. So, Fringe, you also managed to get the getting by, indicated by the fact that you've taken an odd job here or there that pays well enough for you to not worry about your lifestyle.
Cool.
So, first off, is Fringe doing what Kane asked, and that is keeping kind of a surreptitious eye on various church members?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So what other job has Fringe picked up that pays moderately
well? Pays moderately well. Well, I mean, does she have to have an actual job, or could she just...
No, it's just you've been doing something that paid decently, so you did some kind some kind of coin.
I've been working my way through like Mother Bastion's underlings, impersonating them briefly enough that I can go and like swipe a tax collection or two.
Okay.
And then disappearing into the crowd.
That works, because then it dovetails with what you're already doing. So yes. That sounds good to me.
Dovetail. It's like perfect.
That's awesome.
All right. So Kane, you indicated in the, in our group that we have set up that Kane is feeling conflicted because he really does feel a connection to the Cult of the New God, but you don't like the church members. So you were hoping to get onto Mother Bastion's staff to keep an eye on it because you want the church to do well, but you don't trust the people that are in authority in this region. Correct?
Dude, somebody's been stealing tax collection.
People steal tithes like that. That's terrible. So I think after the last session, Mother Bastion's fine with taking a fine devout person like you that's obviously been chosen by the one true God and to her personal staff. So you're going to be on the staff. You're actually in charge of some of the lesser guards. I mean, it's not a high position, but it pays decently. And you got the comfortable lifestyle. So if you could give me an intellect challenge roll with one bane... You're automatically comfortable, and then you might have saved up extra money on top of that.
So that is 11.
All right. So, yes, you saved up 4 additional copper pieces on top of living fairly comfortably while you're here at this particular location. But you have, you've got like 4 guards that kind of answer to you, and you've been following Mother Bastion around the city because for some reason people are not trusting Mother Bastion, and there's a bunch of like rumors flying about her, and she's almost certain that like some of the nobles are hiring people to potentially assassinate her, and so she's really paranoid now because she's been hearing all these bad things about her that she has no idea where they came from. So you and your 4 people that are directly under you have been walking around with her anytime she's in public. She's been in public less and less anymore. So that's where we start off with what everyone's been doing the last month. So the other thing, just to throw this out there, Abigail ran across her noble contact that was one of her best customers and was discredited in the last year. So, what he told you, besides the fact that he's hiding out in the tent city so no one finds him.
Yes.
Is that rumor has it among some of the nobles that he can still talk to that won't turn him over, that Sir Regis Morn, the guy that disappeared when he first arrived in your town when it got destroyed and then resurfaced later, Sir Regis is actually the bastard son of Prince Horus. And there's rumors that Eris, the Horus's court wizard, is trying to get Horus to name Sir Regis as his official heir, since he never got married and had a child that he could officially, pass his mantle down to.
Okay. Ryan, if you're filling in the sound effects now, this is where you do the bum bum bum.
That's good to know.
Yes, you can. That would be appropriate at this point in time.
Yeah, I know, and I'm trying to think about how she will react to his information. The other question is, Sir Regis Morn was going with, at the time, Mother Bastion and her order. Mm-hmm. Does my noble friend know what order she's actually a part of? Because she's sure as hell not an Inquisitor.
I will roll to see. Unfortunately, he is not certain. Apparently the dice gods have decided that part of the plot will not be revealed to you guys yet.
I am trying. All right. Well, honestly, knowing that Gideon is in the tent city, it actually makes her a little bit happier to know that he is safe. Does she know what he was actually accused of?
There was just a bunch of various specious charges about, treason and undermining the civil authority of the city, and it was all extremely vague, but it was all enough that he had to flee his position, because there's enough nobles that are swaying by, he could be a secret agent for the orcs, or he could be, working for this other province that's going to take us over. And there's enough of a level of paranoia among the nobles right now that pretty much was all it took.
Got it.
It is interesting, though, that the charges against him are purely political. No one's actually accused him of being a heretic, which is possibly better, because he doesn't automatically have the Inquisition after him. He's just got the nobility seizing his assets and saying that he's not a noble anymore.
Got it. Well, that just doesn't make... That makes things that much worse, but
is the glass half full way of being a social pariah?
Yeah, that's about it. And there's not really a safe place for him to go elsewhere, because the empire is run by orcs now.
Yeah.
He can't even leave the province.
He could try and make it over to next door is, the it's failing me now. The religious state where you guys borrowed a bunch of troops from.
Yeah.
But, that's dicey.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't. I wouldn't do that, because isn't that run by the cult of the new god?
Yes.
Yeah, those people are crazy. present party members excluded.
Included, you mean?
And then our last little connections to people. Kane, as you've been helping out Mother Bastion, Father Stone of the Church of the Martyrs Radiant Blood that has, kind of took you guys in initially when you first came to the city. It's up to you whether you've decided that you agree with this or not, but Father Stone himself seems like a fairly upright guy. He seems like the type of person that you would hope most of the members of the cult of the New Gods clergy would be like. And Father Stone has become kind of like whether or not you've opened up to him, he's kind of opened up to you and kind of told you that he's really concerned about the local clergy, that the cult of the new god is going through a lot of trials just because, you know, the empire falling and every province kind of deciding on their own what they want to do. It's really got him worried, and he wishes there was a stronger moral center for the church right now. So I'll let you decide whether you like him, whether you trust him or what, but Father Stone has been kind of opening up to you and talking to you a little bit more over this last month as you've been working as Mother Bastion's guard.
Is Father Stone the bishop?
No. Father Stone is just the local priest at this church that you guys first came to when you came to the town.
All right. Sorry, Kane. Sorry about that.
The bishop was Bishop Mazin.
Yeah. Bishop Mazin was Inquisition before he became a bishop, so not quite as man of the people.
Got it. Okay. Sorry. Carry on.
Does Father Stone know anything about, like, any specific things about why he believes certain people are corrupt, or does he have any evidence, or?
Well, the first thing that you hear is you hear him, like, recount all of these stories that he's heard about Mother Bastion sneaking around town, using dark speech, creeping around people's estates. And that just really bothers him. The other thing that he's worried about is, for example, Bishop Mazin. Now there's rumors that there's rumors within the church that there might be some corruption involved there that's only kind of started to spread in this last month. But even before that, he's worried that Bishop Mazin is too political. He's worried that he's always been telling Prince Horace that he needs to more actively espouse the church because the church helped him tame this region. And he's afraid that the Bishop Mazin is going to basically tell the Prince Horace that he either has to declare himself emperor or go to war or declare this its own empire, and that it has to be a theocracy, basically. And he's wanting him to set up, you know, where essentially like how the pontiff of the cult of the new god will christen the emperor. He kind of wants him to set up something like that here in this province, and all of that bothers him and feels way too political for his liking.
Is Horace seen as the legitimate heir for the empire?
In this province, yeah. He's
go local team.
Yeah. I mean, he is directly the emperor that was murdered by the orcs was his nephew.
Okay, cool.
Does Finch or Kane find anything strange about Father Stone in the past month?
Fringe and Kane both give me a perception challenge roll.
Challenge rule. Do I get any bonus for having Shadow Sight?
Yeah, I'll give you a bonus for it because you might have seen him walking around at night, and this is kind of an amalgam of what happened over the last month or so.
So I've got a 15.
Oh, he did better than me. I got 12.
Okay. But both of you got more than a 10. So you pick up two different things about Father Stone. At one point, he generally always wears his full vestments. They're not like overly fancy like Mother Bastion's, but he does have the full formal, you know, they're humble, but he's always wearing the full formal outfit. And at one point, Kane, you noticed what looks like it doesn't look like a tattoo. It looks like it's been, it looks like a pentagram scarified at the base of his neck. So it's like,
right?
Like burned into his flesh, and it's an upside down one, not the right side up one like practitioners of witchcraft might.
Not like Abby carries.
Yeah. and friend, you notice that when you were following him at one particular time when he was going home from the church at night, his eyes seem to glow red. Oh. Only when he's in complete darkness. But they glow red in complete darkness.
That's not normal.
Hey, what's normal? I mean,
oh boy, does it sound good?
But
I don't have anything to move on that. So that's just information for me to share. I can't personally.
Yeah, the crux of this is, though, what's really weird, Hayne, you get the feeling he is an upright guy. I mean, he seems very forthright to you. It's just, that's kind of disturbing stuff to notice.
It's not necessarily any worse than half of our group, so. Even me, really, because I was a saboteur before, so it's possible people can change their ways. But well, I'm certainly going to be undecided on the case.
Is that marking that's on his neck, is that something that, like, a cult might do to a captive?
Maybe, but I mean, you didn't see it, so really all you hear is him describing that it kind of looks like it's the main thing is it's not a tattoo. It's definitely something that's either like a scar or a burn. It's hard to tell unless you just, like, you know, held him down and yanked his vestments up over his head and looked at it.
You know who would have given us insight into this? Is Teapot. Teapot would have had a good idea about this.
I would guess so.
Yeah.
Where is that guy? I haven't seen him around lately.
I'm also going to throw this out here, too. Since you work at the church, give me a... I'm going to say that you're here just about every day, since this is where Mother Bastion often does all of her stuff, because she stays away from the main cathedral, because she doesn't want to look like she's trying to take over the bishop's powers. Since you're at this church, give me a perception challenge roll, and we'll give you two banes on it.
Oh, so that's okay. A three.
So you, what you notice is you do see one morning when you come into the church, there's like gears and metal bits scattered all over the front of the church. And there's this black burn in the ground that looks like something blew up. However, you do not...
And it's got those cool dead angel wings from Supernatural, except they're very, very small.
Yeah. the little tiny burned angel wings from when the angels blow up on Supernatural. But the one thing that you don't notice, not that Hayne would necessarily be thinking this, but you don't find the book or the key or anything. You just find these gear bits and the burn marks on the floor.
And Teapot's been missing. That's it, right?
And oddly, a small tentacle.
Yeah, there's a little fleshy tentacle laying on the ground that's a little weird, too. You don't know what's going on with that, but that's kind of your life right now.
This could turn a whole long, strange discussion if we weren't on air. Anyway.
This is a rated R game. However, yes, even on air, there are some things we don't want to think about.
Hey, that reminds me. I forgot to do the disclaimer at the beginning of the thing, but Shadow of the Demon Lord is a game that deals with disturbing topics. So if disturbing topics would disturb you now that, you know, we're 15 minutes into the broadcast or so, hey, don't watch this.
Sorry in retrospect for the sanity loss.
Yeah. So at this point now, now that all that's happened, you've gathered all this information about your wonderful surroundings. Hayne, you're in contact with Mother Bastion just about every day. She comes up to you and she goes, Hayne, I need you to assemble your friends. I have a divine mission for you. I want you to call forward the cohort of the chosen. Yes, I have decided that is the name for you and your friends because they are all chosen by the new god.
Great, Avengers assemble.
When I first met this lady, she really had kind of a, like, you know, Mother Teresa kind of vibe to her. Now she's got more of a Jim Jones kind of vibe to her.
But I need you to assemble the cohort of the chosen and to do a very important task for me. And she pulls out what looks like a compass, but it's a compass with a little reservoir in it. And the reservoir is filled with a red liquid. I need you to follow this compass and retrieve someone for me. It is very important to the future of the church and to mankind as a whole, because as we know, the new God is very interested in what's going on right here. And I just need you to make sure that this gets done. And she hands you over the compass.
Can you give me at least a description of the person, so you know if there's more than one person there?
Well, I don't want you to cause any kind of panic, but the bishop has disappeared. It is believed that he may have been kidnapped by fairy creatures.
Bishop Mazin?
Yes, Bishop Mazin. Now, he could still be useful to the faith, as corrupted as he is, so I would like him returned so that he can properly appoint a successor and to do all the things that he needs to do to put that in order. However, I need to know his disposition one way or the other. So while I would love for him to come back alive, should a horrible accident befall him, should the one true God see fit to make sure that he no longer draws breath and that his soul descends to the afterworld, I need proof that his soul has descended to the afterworld. I am only slightly more concerned that he comes back and performs his duties, because clearly if it is the will of the one true God that he no longer draw breath, then that is truly the will of the one true God. But one way or the other, I need him back either alive or dead. And I need the cohort of the chosen to do this for me.
Does she take a minor action to nudge, nudge, wink, wink here? Or what?
Yes.
There is sort of a spiritual nudge, nudge, wink, wink going on when she's saying this.
So she's asking us to kill the bishop.
No, no.
No, just find the bishop.
Not at all.
Jeez. How does Cain feel about that?
Well, Cain doesn't really trust either of them, so. I mean, well, it would certainly help to find out who kidnapped him. That doesn't seem like something we want happening, so.
I'll also throw out here the fact that I'm just going to state this leave it for you. She has a compass that can track people by putting blood in it. I'm just.
And once more, we think, this would be interesting if Teapot was here.
Yes.
Yeah, if Vegas was a sharper tack, you know, he may question where she got his blood to track him in the first place.
Maybe.
I don't know. This is speaking of all sorts of Mother Bastion is bad news, but that's just me.
So Cain, you
already know that.
Yeah.
Yes. But.
You definitely know where Fringe is because you regularly kind of meet up and exchange information. So Fringe will be easy to find. I'm going to say Vigdis and Abigail are probably fairly easy to find since they're wandering the tent city and seeing like a pretty woman ministering to the crowds and then a 9 foot tall that probably stand out a little bit.
I was thinking we could just light up the cohort contraption and put a big symbol in the sky and
a big serpent circle in the sky.
cohort collate or something. Congregate, that's it. Cohort congregate. See?
I was gonna say, no, if you're trying to give us Kool-Aid, then no, I'm not drinking that.
You probably don't find Fringe. You probably go to a place, hang out, and do a thing. And then, like a spy movie, Fringe shows up.
Have you guys seen Yojimbo before?
I have not.
I've seen it, but it's been a while.
Long time. So there's a character, a little bit that Toshiro Mifune does in it, where he keeps like shifting in his kimono, like as if it doesn't fit properly. That's what Vigdis does all the time. Like whenever he has to stand still, he's kind of sitting there doing. So it's probably quite easy to pick him out in a crowd.
So yeah, you do your Cain can do his random like, I'd like to order two ales and a sandwich. We don't have sandwiches here. I know. And then Fringe pops up.
They don't have sliced bread there. Wait.
You think this is the
I guess I was gonna ask if over the past month if we heard anything else about these three witches or the troll spell, because that's in my notes too.
Actually, I'm gonna say you probably heard this because this is something we talked about with Teapot before he exploded. Teapot was actually planning on mounting an expedition to go see the three witches. And because there was a massive storm that blew up, he had to abandon his plans. You haven't heard anything through the grapevine, but you do know that, you know, when Teapot had made that plan to go do that, it didn't work out.
Okay, mountain expedition, and I only found Teapot's tentacle. I understand.
So do you head to the tent city to recruit Abigail and...
Yes, it's time to do that.
All right. And I'm assuming Fringe is going to tag along once
of course
they make the contact. Okay. So you're all in the tent city. You see Abigail ministering to the poor and the refugees and Vigda standing there very uncomfortable. What do you do?
Go up to Vigdis and tell him, you know, hey, we got a job. It's time for us to get together, and Mother Bastion would like us to follow this compass and just show him the compass quick and then hide it again.
Okay. Vigdis doesn't quite understand what he's looking at, but he completely trusts Kane, so yeah.
And Vigdis, thus the reason Abby's worried for Vigdis.
So Vigdis sort of like will walk over to Abby and sort of like tug at her robe and like, Abby, we've got something, we can hit something.
Oh, God. All right, well, Vigdis, Abby turns to him and finishes up, and well, the healer's kit is out. I was finishing splinting an arm. And at this point, you know, she's out of healing supplies for now. And so she says, well, I have to go get more healing supplies, and I'll be back once I can obtain those from the main city, and I'll be ministering and all of that later. And she puts on her hat and says, okay, Vigdis and Kane and Fringe, nods to each of them and says, and starts following. And she goes up to Kane and says, okay, what's going on? And assumes that Kane gives him her kind of a rundown.
Yep. Lets her know what's happening. And go ahead. Sorry. Do we have a certain place to meet up or what, I guess is what I was wondering.
Well, Abby has Abby has a small apartment that we could probably use, especially if she's comfortable, you know, that would be somewhere private. We could all meet.
Small.
Well, okay. Small for Vigdis. Okay. it's a two-room apartment. The larger entry room is where Vigdis sleeps. The back room is where the shrine and where Abby sleeps it. but she wouldn't subject anybody to her stuff. But the entry room would be a good place for us to meet and kind of discuss what's going on.
Okay. So you meet at Abby's in the cohort mansion.
Yes, in the cohort mansion. It's not a big place, but it's enough for what we need.
Yeah, your team has a name, so it has to be the mansion now. So.
Oh, cohort compound.
Yeah, compound would be safer.
It could also be tower, but it's not a tower, so.
No, we don't have enough gold for that yet. I have to scam a few more nobles for that.
All right, so, you know, basically the Mother Bastion has let us know that Father Maison was captured by elves, so we have to go kill every elf we can find. No, not really, but hey, anyway, I don't know if they were elves or not, but we do have this compass here that is full of Kool-Aid, and we can chase this Kool-Aid down and find him.
One Jim Jones reference and one Kool-Aid reference in the last hour. This is going to end terribly well.
This is okay. So we freed the one elf, and the one elf was leaving town. While elves aren't necessarily the most are fickle. We have no reason to believe that they would have any reason to stay in town. or that elf, the Knight Errant, would have any reason to stay in town. Why would they have any reason to mess with Father Bash or with the bishop?
Revenge.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't Vigdis saying this. This is just Kevin saying this, but the I mean, if they didn't, the bishop kidnap him in the first place,
her,
and was like,
yeah.
I mean, who knows where those souls came from?
Yeah, it's true. The souls could have been fae souls.
Obviously, he was messing with the elves in general, so it doesn't seem so surprising to me. Hmm. And honestly, it doesn't really matter, does it?
I think that's doctrinally consistent to try and the fae are not of the new god. So
true. I mean, they're closer. I mean, truly, they're closer to my faith than anything else.
Yeah.
And even that, they're nowhere near my faith. I mean, I can't see them. I just seems odd that they would just come back for no reason other than to capture him. Somebody has to have effectively let them in.
And it may not even be. I don't even know if it's elves for sure. It was when we were told fae creatures. So.
I don't know any fae creatures. Fringe. But
no, I don't. I don't really know anybody.
So do we know anything that? So I'm going to say this, and not thinking about Fringe here at the moment. Do we know or have anything that would work well against fae creatures? Would my knowledge of nature know what works well against fae creatures?
Well, you've already kind of come up with the idea that iron is a bad thing from your last, you know, seeing the elf mm-hmm. that was imprisoned in the cage. So you would know about the iron vulnerability thing.
Hmm. Okay.
For however Fringe feels about employing iron.
If they bleed, we can kill them.
This is true.
They just mutter something in trollish. Supportive.
Picture even like supportive statements from Vigdis in trollish sound a little disturbing.
Yeah.
Rock Kaba!
It's like saying I love you in Klingon.
Yeah. I was gonna say that sounded like Klingon. Kane suggests that we just head out and then, you know, we can talk on the way.
Okay.
I'd rather have this business finished.
Vigdis wants to know, he points at the compass that Kane has out and says, does it tell you how close?
I don't really know. I'll pass it over to Abby so she can check it out more closely.
It's just giving you a direction. So the upside is you're probably not going to get lost while you're following it, but you don't know how far it is to go. You do know the Forest of Screams itself, if they headed that direction, is about 2 weeks on foot.
So I'm pretty smart, right? How accurate is this compass? Like, does it have a lot of bob and movement to it, or is it fairly
stable? Yeah, it's a fairly complex mechanism. I mean, it's,
Well, I say, give me that, and I'll let you know in 30 minutes. And then I'll walk, you know, I'll look at it very closely, mark maybe lightly with some dirt where the compass is, and then, you know, walk 15 minutes west and mark where it changes, and then make a, you know, math calculation. She's probably smarter than I am. I'm not good with math. And figure out if it's like, I just need to know if I need to get like lots of supplies.
So I'm going to say, if you're going to try and like figure out like extrapolated long-term things, I will let you do that, but you'll give me an intellect challenge with two banes because you're trying to really read stuff that it doesn't denote. They're there. I mean, it's a complex mechanism. But it's not like spelled out on the actual compass.
Basically, how much does it change if he moves 50 feet to the west?
Yeah,
it doesn't 15 change minutes very much. Well, 15. Yeah, if it doesn't change very much, then
yeah,
10 on the dot.
All right then. Yeah. If you look at this and you look at the map and you know that it's about 2 weeks to the Forest of Screams, it seems like it's pretty much almost all the way there.
All right. Well, then we need some provisions because we're not necessarily going to live off the land here.
I'm a forest scout.
Well, I could certainly, you know, find food with my knowledge of nature and things like that. We could certainly find things that we could safely eat. That I'm not worried about. I'm worried about getting there in a timely manner, because if this guy is in danger, I don't want to, you know, even if he's corrupt and it's a necessary reason to be in, bring him to justice, I think it's safer to bring him to justice in town rather than, you know, I don't know what I'm trying to say.
I understand what you're saying.
For three silver pieces, for three silver pieces, we can each have a horse with a bridle, saddlebag, saddle, and blanket. So I say we take this, and maybe we should all just go for that if we had that kind of money.
I think Vigdis stands next to the horse like a person standing next to a mid-sized dog.
Yeah, Vigdis is probably the only one who can't have a horse.
If we got a cart with a draft horse, I could just ride in the cart.
That's kind of what I was thinking. Was
Vigdis is doing the whole Ben-Hur thing.
Yeah, he kind of bangs the side of the cart and he says, "Good for loot."
I'll give him that one actually, because that makes sense. And I'm looking for the price of a cart, like a horse cart, where you can have one horse and a cart. And I'm not finding a price. Like, I see prices for horses and animals and animal gear, but I don't see a price for a cart.
Give me one. It might
surprise me.
Demon Lord's Companion?
That's what I was just pulling up here.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to buy myself 4 weeks' rations.
Okay. And if you have horses, you'll get there in about 6 days instead of 2 weeks.
Cart's on page 32 of the Companion. It's 2 gold crown.
All right. Holy shit. Holy cow. And that's a single horse cart?
I think so, yes.
All right, I'll buy the cart. I've got the gold for it.
I'm interested in knowing this. Are horses as badass in this as they are in like every other thing, or do they just act as vehicles that increase your speed?
Riding horses are just going to be things that you're riding. They're not going to...
They don't get hoof attacks and shit, because normally they just wreck stuff.
All
right. I'm serious, dude. A horse is like a second level character in most games.
So I get a cart. I need to get a bit and bridle, excuse me, and the horse, which puts me down not horribly. Thank you, nobles, for giving us money.
I was remiss in not pointing this out before, but Mother Bastion did offer you 5 gold coins for this job. So
okay. Each or
yes. Each.
Up front?
Is the bishop not up front now?
Oh, that bitch.
Can I argue for getting it up front?
No, because you wasn't.
All right, fair enough.
Thank you, nobles, because they're the ones who pay up front. And then we're going to need food, and Vigdis eats a lot. So.
Also good for the cart.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, we can throw food into the cart and water into the cart and feed in the cart. Good night. I'm trying to think of how much we're going to need to actually have. Basically, I'm going to spend another... Can I just spend like another gold crown and just have enough food?
Oh, sure. Food like a copper for a week of rations. You probably
won't. Yeah, 2 copper for it. So 1 silver piece is going to be...
Yeah.
5 weeks.
Yeah.
All right, but I'm also thinking feed for the animals, which is one bit per day.
Yeah.
I'm picturing there's a scene where as everything's getting ready, Vigdis comes loping over with this like 2 big casks of ale in his arms. He kind of looks at, like, hopefully at Abby, and Abby's like, without a word, just
no.
His head down, and he goes and puts it back.
Oh.
All right, so I spend the silver on rations, and I spend my coppers on feed for the horse.
Did Fringe got hit by a door trap last time, right? Okay, never mind then. No 10-foot pole.
No, no, you're completely confident that you can disarm any trap. Yeah, because that all went well last time.
What if this guy doesn't want to go with us? Maybe we should get some manacles.
She suggests, he just sort of like taps his, he taps his shield want. With his axe, and he says he will want to come with us.
So I'll get some manacles.
So I'm assuming that you're going to be extremely careful when handling the manacles.
Yeah, I have. Can I just pay double and get steel manacles, or is steel just not available?
You'll still count in this.
Do you wear gloves?
Yeah. Can I just wear gloves?
Yeah.
Oh, there we go then. I probably wear gloves anyway, so whenever I switch, yeah.
Yeah, you have to do the rogue thing.
Yeah. I'm gonna make sure I keep my extra arrows in the cart too, so I have a total of 10 arrows handy.
Okay.
I'll make a fine gloves even.
See, now you mentioned having arrows and a bow, so I'm picturing Abigail like Inara with her bow and.
Well, and really, compared to historical archers, she really is more in line with your historical Welsh archers. You know, soft leather armor, a bow, and a dagger. Because I was rereading the sword, and from the first session, I'm like, she can't use that without a bane. At least a bane.
A little heavy for her.
So I'm glad we hand waved that session, but yeah. she's not exactly heavily armed.
That makes sense, though.
Okay. Yeah, she's heel bot.
You have all of your provisions. You have some horses. It's going to take you 6 days to get to where the compass is pointing. Halfway between where you're at now and Holdfast, which is the city, is Midkeep, which is another population concentration, but it's set up more like a military fortress. So you'll hit Midkeep about 3 days in, and then three more days you'll hit the forest, as long as you're mounted or on a cart.
Okay. In the course of the journey, I think Vigdis will sort of take it upon himself to be the one who's caring for all the animals and stuff like that. So he'll do the, you know, making sure that they're all, you know, like combed and whatever else. He'll take everyone's saddles off. And it becomes apparent on day two that he has named the cart horse Harold.
Awesome.
Got it. The cart horse is Harold.
So, for each day of the travel, I'm going to roll a fortune die. Or not a fortune die. I can't remember what the term is. Basically, if I roll a one, it's a bad thing. If I roll a six, it's a good thing. So I have a list of good and bad things that can happen each day of the travel. So we're going to do the first days. Hey, I got one the first day.
Sounds like a misfortune day.
So you got one good thing happened the first day. And that good thing that happened the first day is entry number three. The weather is perfect. The terrain is idyllic. Everyone that doesn't have fortune currently gains it. How could anything possibly go wrong?
Love it.
So that was your first day. First day was just great. And also, a side thing, whenever I don't decide, you know, what time of year something's going to be, I default to it's this time of year that I'm running it. So this is, you know, March. It's kind of still, I'm not sure what the month name would be here, but it's still kind of fluctuating between winter and spring. So it's kind of a tempestuous month as far as whether it's going to be cold or beautiful or anything like that. I'm thinking, I was trying to look geographically at where the borderlands of Tyr are, and they look like they would still be in a temperate zone and still way short, you know, south of the desolation and all of that stuff. So I'm assuming there are still, you know, weather and everything. There's pine forests and mountains around here. So if I'm wrong, then I'm really off, but I couldn't find anything that would contradict that this is in a temperate band, so.
I actually live in a city that's right at the foot of the Canadian Rockies, which is sort of the default environment for most gaming things, so.
Yeah.
It's real easy to get reference photos for stuff.
All right, so the first day went well. Second day, nothing particularly happens one way or the other, but you had a great first day. But the second day, you see figures off in the distance. And they seem to be, like, give me a perception challenge roll. Everybody, if you would like.
Well,
do I get a bonus for my dark sightiness or no?
Not this time because this is broad daylight.
Yeah, okay, I got 11.
15.
Okay. These guys, it doesn't look like they're trying to be stealthy per se, but it does look like they're intentionally tracking you guys, and they've just kind of closed the distance with you. And they're, you know, they like every time you kind of go around a bend, if you pick a certain way, they go the exact same way. So after about an hour of observing this, you notice that they're definitely following you, not just going in the same direction as you. So what would you guys like to do?
Vigdis will stand up on the cart and he'll just whack his shield two times and then shout out, "We see you!"
I will take that immediate opportunity to change shape into one of them and disappear into the woods.
Oh. So what you see as they get closer and as Vigdis as hails them, essentially, you notice three figures following you. One of them is jogging, and there's like steam and gears going off when they're jogging.
Sorry, guys, I think we've lost Jason.
Oh, no.
Is
Don gone, or did he just have to sign out for a second?
He didn't no say. Message.
Okay. I think it's probably the internet.
All right. Well, hopefully.
Well, he succeeded his stealth check at the start of the encounter.
So I'll still frame this and we'll hopefully he'll be able to pop back in. But basically what you see is a tall but not like gigantic clockwork creature that looks like it has been built for combat that's carrying a sword. And then you see a tall man that kind of looks familiar, but you're not exactly sure, but he appears human. And then Vigdis, you see Arno.
Oh.
Arno and the tall man are both riding horses. The clockwork is just kind of like jogging really fast to keep up with him, but you can tell he's been built with a longer stride. And you, as soon as you say, "We see you," Arno looks back at you and goes, "Aye, I see you too, you big stinky bastard."
Oh, crap.
I think Vigdis isn't quite sure what to do with this, so he points at him and looks at Abby and says, "Arno!"
Oh, and I've got the and I'm driving the cart for Pete's sake. And we have a clockwork that is as big as Vigdis, don't we?
No.
Or the.
There's a human who's quite big.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. There. Oh no. It's not as big as Vigdis. He's just. It's man sized. It's just clearly built for combat. So it's not like a little spindly clockwork. It's got all the little pistons and everything for sword gutting and bat hook sort of thing.
Okay. So it's a warrior.
So Vigdis will, I think, look at Arno and say, "That's close enough. You leave, or I'll break your toys."
And Arno goes, "Ha, you know what? We're doing the same job that you're gonna do, except you're gonna help us get there, and then we're gonna make money off of you, big lug." And the man next to him is just kind of shaking his head the entire change.
It's like the two dumbest characters trying to have witty repartee back and forth. No, you're going to do the job.
All right, so wait a minute. But Abby's picking up on something, and Abby's going to have a lovely witty retort here at Arno. Arno, what job are you doing?
There's some nobles in town that found out that the bishop and the tall man like hammers Arno in the side.
at this point, the tall man needs to fall into ecstasy.
is there a roll for this?
There is. It is all a right. Will roll.
Okay.
And that's a natural 20.
Yeah, that's higher than his. The taller man starts looking at you. My lady, I'm very sorry. We can't tell you. Oh, my God.
And then he falls prone.
So the taller man falls off of his horse and is kind of like doubled over. And Arno looks down at him and looks at you. And since he's from your town, he looks at you and goes,
yes, I am that good.
I know you are good, but... Oh, man.
That was hilarious.
So, yeah, the tall man is on the ground. Writhing, not in pain.
He needs to clean himself up
now. So, Jason, in case you missed it, this party... that just rode up on you consists of Arno, a tall man that you kind of recognize, and a tall clockwork that appears to be built for combat. The two breathing people have horses, and Abby just cast ecstasy on the tall man, and he fell off of his horse.
Not just cast ecstasy, she got the best possible result with that spell.
Yeah.
He's dazed for one round and slowed for one round, and he has fallen prone.
So
Arno, so since he's now prone and stunned, let's
Arno, don't go ahead.
I think Vignus sees this happen, and then he looks at Arno again and says, "Leave. Or we'll break your other toy."
And the clockwork looks at everything that's going on and it's this mechanical, like, you know, reverberating voice, but like he's, "Hey man, there's no need for this to get this out of hand. I mean, we can all just kill. I'm sure there's plenty of gold to go around for everybody. We could just like work together or something, right?"
That's awesome. And it was like someone speaking through like one of those tracheotomy devices, like, "Hey man, I don't even know this guy."
And you notice, like, as he's talking and everyone's getting tense, he's taking like this grease out of a packet and like rubbing it inside his joints.
Yeah, we should all just chill out.
Vignus?
Yeah, it looks at Abby.
He's gonna try to break you. And she points at the big guy.
Vignus still narrows, standing. He narrows his eyes and says, "He can try." And then is that Abby's, like, you know, go get him, boy?
I'm gonna look to Kane and say, I think they're gonna try to kill us in our sleep.
Yeah, they're definitely not invited. You guys should all leave now.
And the clockwork is just like, "Man, everything's going so hostile. This isn't the way I pictured it at all." And so Arno is all in. He's like, "I'm going to cut your kneecaps off, you big pale bastard."
"That's all you can reach."
So with that.
That's a true statement.
This is going to be combat. Thanks. So, I'm going to, like, since we're entering combat, the effects that Abby got on the tall guy start from when combat starts, so.
Yay!
How
close are we?
What's that?
How close are we? Are they one zone away, or?
Well, I'm going to say, since they started talking to you, your zone's here for your outdoor on the plains. You have rolling plains, the edge of a slight hill, and near the tree line. Everybody is within the rolling plains. They're all one zone in the same zone. Because basically, once you called them out, Arno started, like, kept moving towards you and yelling at you while he's talking. And everything. And the taller guy's just like shaking his head, like, no, this.
All right. Well, before as this occurs, can I ride up from out of the woods and point at the dude that had been hit by the ecstasy and scream imposter? And, you know, Arno, slay him now before he transforms, before it transforms.
I will let you do that for your first thing if okay. you want to do that for your fast turn.
All right. I was kind of waiting for the right moment. And I will take my fast turn to do that, and I want to go first.
Okay. So you're going a fast turn. You go first. You come out looking like the tall man. Also, anybody can make an intellect challenge roll to see if they can remember where they know this guy from. Oh. But
nope.
Before we convince his allies to kill him.
Vignus is blinded by his hatred of Arno.
One of those poor guys that's just like, you guys don't remember me? Seriously? I'm your arch nemesis.
I got a success.
Okay. This is the guard at the bishop's place that you shoved down the stairs. He was dismissed from his job after that and is now working as a mercenary.
Guys, this is our poor guy.
Oh, that poor guy. Not only have I bewitched him.
So, Fringe, give me an intellect attack against Arno. And
This is my subterfuge, my roguery talent.
You will get that as a, you will get to use that.
Damn. I will use my trickery with this as well.
Nice.
So I have a boom.
All right.
20 plus 1 plus 1d6. 17.
A 17 is higher than Arno's will, amazingly enough. So Arno looks at you at the tree line, and he looks at the guy with him. He goes, "I've been riding with an imposter this entire time." So Arno is tricked, but he can't go yet. But he seems firmly convinced that, you know, of course, why would the guy he's been traveling with be, like, you know, making happy noises and writhing on the ground right now? That makes no sense at all. Of course he's an imposter. So would anyone else like to take a fast turn?
No, Vegas is taking slow.
Okay.
Abby is going to take a slow.
Okay.
I'll take a fast turn. I'll attack the clockwork dude.
All right. Hey, man, I'm not a threat, man. I mean, I'll kill you if I have to, but I mean, killing's just what I do, not what I do.
It's not who I am.
In the movie version, is the clockwork voiced by Jeff Bridges?
Yeah, I think so. This is the soul of someone very Jeff Bridges is like that has been called back for this clockwork.
Love it.
So yes, go ahead and make your.
Well, does he look like he is going to fight, or is he not going to?
Yeah, he does. He just looks conflicted. Like, he doesn't want to, but he's going to because that's what they hire him to do. It's just his heart's not in it.
Nice.
Couldn't we just kill the other two and hire him?
I actually say we tie the other two. We tie the other two up. We've got manacles. I believe Fringe got some manacles.
I do. I do have some manacles.
All right. But, I'll throw my net on him then.
Okay.
Ooh.
Let me see. I gotta open up to see how the dang net works again. All right. It's just an attack.
All right.
And I'm assuming it's in a weapon, so I can use my weapon attack.
Mm-hmm.
My weapon training, so I get a boon, yeah. And that's that. So that would be a 12, 14. Is it an 8? Do I get would it be agility or it doesn't matter, I get a +1 either way. So 15.
All right, 15 hits his defense. So what does the net do to him once you throw it on him?
Oh, I make a strength roll against the target's agility on it. So it was a strength roll, so it would have been, it wouldn't have been the +2. It would only be against the target's agility, so it would be a 12, 13, I guess.
Yeah, that's actually better for you. If it's a strength roll against his agility.
Does the net hits and the target becomes slowed. While slowed, he makes attack rolls, agility challenges rolls with a bane.
Okay.
He can use an action to cut his way free from the net, which ruins it, or escape with an agility challenge roll.
So you throw this on him, he's like, man. This seems kind of annoyed here. Okay, so for their fast turns, Arno doesn't want to waste any time, and he's within arm's length of the imposter. So he's going to back down from his horse onto the guy on the ground. And so Arno, with his sword, that is that with one. Okay. So Arno hits the guy writhing on the ground right now. Arno went, and he hits the guy and does... Wow. Doesn't kill him, but he tears a big gash into the guy's shoulder.
Gah.
He's like, oh God.
Well, pleasure and pain, I guess.
So good it hurts. Yes, this feels so good it hurts.
I think I'm gonna make a check for the yeah. So the clockwork is in the net now, and he looks at the net and he goes, "Oh no, man!" And you notice like he takes one of his hands and he like wraps himself further in the net and he goes, "Oh man, I'm tangled."
Oh.
Looks like I'm out of this fight.
I like this guy. Yeah.
Makes the decision for Vignes quite easy on picking targets now.
So now, slow turn.
Okay. Vignes screams out in Trollish his battle cry, which is, "Dibs!" And he's going to attack Arno. Oh, that's not good. I got a 5. I got a 9.
Okay, yeah, 9 is much lower than his defense because
I figured.
He apparently he's got some good backing because he's got some good armor and weapons on him now compared to the drunk, you know, former mercenary that you knew before.
Yeah.
So whether that tells you who he's working for or not, they have got some money behind him.
Okay.
Yeah, it clangs off of his mail and shield, and he's okay.
So I think like Vignes probably like assumed that he would be the slow, you know, lethargic drunk that he was before, and just didn't make it, you know, put his full effort into the strike. Ooh.
And let's see what were the effects for the oh yeah, Abigail, did you want to take an action now?
Is King. Kane took a fast action, so yeah, Abby will actually look to Arno now, and she is going to bewitch Arno and say, "Walk away," and that is her order.
Okay.
This is hold on, let me get this right. This is an intellect attack, I believe. Yep, intellect attack against the target's intellect. On a success, he's moved up to his speed.
Okay.
And I'm hoping... All right. My dice are on fire.
Okay.
that is the second 20.
Wow.
So I also regained the casting of this spell.
Nice.
That's awesome.
That's and this is on two different dice, by the way. My first roll of the day, so I get a 7, a 1 when you'd ask for the perception check, so everybody else beat me on that. and then 20, like, okay. So Arno is told to walk away.
What's interesting here is you guys so far have not seen Abby throw this much magical power around, and she's just like slinging it this time around. So, Arno looks at Vignes and goes, "I know you want me to stay and fight, but now," because in his mind he's still reconciling this, even though it's against his will. "I know that if you want me to fight, if I walk away, I actually win." And he rolls off the horse and starts like crawling away from the horse.
Okay, so as he does that, I'm using my triggered action to beam him with my axe.
All right.
See, there's a plan here.
God damn it. I just rolled a 3 again, so it's an 11.
You don't get a boon on this from me using my spell?
Oh, no. I got a boon from my weapon training.
Yeah, it's just his regular attack, but...
I tried.
Vigdis is so mad that he's like, and once again hits the ground.
Oh, man. Okay, so, and what all can the big guy do, the former Sir Clendon?
If he, because he's in the net, you mean?
No, the...
Oh, the other guy. One you're asking, Andy.
So under the spell Ecstasy, so he's dazed for one round, slowed for one round, and he's currently prone.
Okay. So he does not get to do anything other than just be there.
Yeah, he gets to be there this round, and next round I guess he would stand up for his slow round.
Yeah. Next round he gets to stand up and go, how did this all go so wrong?
And then we'll offer surrender.
Yeah. All right. So now we are back to the second round. I'm assuming there's no end of round things that are going on. I don't have any. And back to the slow turn of the next round.
How far did Arno go? His kind of reach.
I'm going to say if you have reach, then yeah, you can still reach him without moving.
Sweet, faster.
All right. So Vigdis, would you like to take your fast
yes. I want to hit my Lex Luthor.
For Arno being Lex Luthor is a really sad commentary, huh?
I mean, let's be honest. I mean, Vigdis is no Superman. So, 19.
A 19 does hit him.
Oh, ouch.
Here it is. Nice. 10 points of damage.
All right. Arno is not down, but he is definitely not in good shape after that hit. Ah, you bastard. I was going to win by being the bigger man and walking away. I had already won this contest. You don't understand how this works.
There is no way you are big.
Oh, man. Okay. Anyone
else? Smaller than me?
Hmm? Oh, no. He's caught in a time warp.
I will be taking a slow turn.
Okay.
Does the former guard, does he have to take a fast turn this turn for the slowed condition?
Slowed. Yeah, no, he can only take a slow turn.
He can only take a slow turn. Yeah. Okay. I really want him to stand up and I want to offer, I want him to stand up and I want to offer him a chance to surrender. is really what I want to do. So I think that means that I have to wait for a slow turn, and yeah, that's really all I want to do.
Okay. So Abby's waiting. Kane.
I was just looking to see if there was some way to just do subdual type damage or something to the guy who's chopped up on the ground.
This has come up before. There's not anything that explicitly says it, but I'm going to, I will run with the 5e thought process, and if you're using a melee weapon, if you knock somebody out and they're an NPC, then you can say you knocked them out instead of murdering them to death.
Is there, am I crazy, or are there optionals in Forbidden Rules where like you take a Bane on your attack and then you can subdue the person rather than kill them?
I don't remember reading that, and I read through it, and for some reason that one's not jumping out at me, but I could be wrong. Like I said, for this session, I'm just going to run with the 5e thing. If you're using a weapon that you could conceivably subdue someone with, you can subdue them, because So generally, you can't shoot someone with an arrow to subdue them. You can't light them on fire to subdue them. But, you know, if you got a sword or an axe, you could kind of smack them around and knock them out.
There's no setting my crow for stun.
So, okay.
So would you like to take a fast turn, or are you waiting for a slow turn?
I'll take a fast turn.
Okay.
So, 17, that's a 20.
All right. And you were swinging at?
The guy on the ground.
Okay.
So, I'm pretty sure that means that I also get forceful strike 20. So, it does a D6, 2D6.
Wow.
3D6.
I think Vigdis needs to take some lessons from Kane.
Good night. Kane is Kane will kill people while they're down.
There you go. Ooh, so that's 15, 17 points.
Oh, jeez. All right. I will, and you don't intend to kill him, correct?
Right.
So I'm actually going to say this, since this is Shadow of the Demon Lord, I'm not going to be quite as nice as 5th edition. I'm going to do the fate roll, and so you could kill him, but you're trying not to.
Okay.
Okay. So you do not kill him because that's a 3. So nothing negative happened from that. So you just wonk him really hard, and he goes. He kind of like he does the Hollywood spinning around thing, and then landing on the ground again when he was just like up on one knee to begin with. So.
Okay,
That's a shame. I have the princess or princess bride line lined up as well. Dogged him too hard.
Oh man! So he is down on the ground. So Abigail and Fringe, you both want to take short or long, fast, short.
Slow.
Wow! I can't talk.
That's me this morning.
Slow turns.
Long, fast, short.
Long, fast, short, intermediate, interspatial turns.
Yes.
Sorry about that, guys. Slow turns, yes. Okay.
As a side note, I believe I'm done.
All right. Good to know. So Arno is going to take a fast turn because he just got walloped by the guy that should have realized that he won by walking away. He doesn't understand how this didn't sink in to his big, dumb skull. So he is going to attack him. All right. That's that and that. Okay, that was not good. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure an 8 doesn't hit Vigdis.
Nada.
Arno's dice do not like him. So Arno, like, swings really well. He, like, spins around and says, "Listen, you!" And he's, like, swings at you like he's swatting at you, and he's completely off balance here. So that was his turn. And the clockwork goes, "Oh, man." And you notice, like, he starts, like, he gets his foot tangled in the thing now, and, like, tangles his foot, and he's like, "Whoa, I was trying to get out, but now I'm, like, totally, completely entangled. It's getting worse. I don't know. It's like some puzzle, and I don't know how to work it. Puzzles.
Oh.
And they expand the mind, and my mind is not expanded enough to get out of this net." So his turn is to actually entangle himself further in the net.
Oh, dear.
All right. So slow turns, Abigail and Fringe. Arno is the only one that seems to be participating in the fight because Clendon is knocked out and on the ground.
All right, so Clendon is Abby is going to pull rope from her bag and tie Clendon up. Okay. That is going to be her turn.
All right.
The only one up. I will move up to Arno.
Okay.
And trickery him and stab him in the throat.
Yeah, because Arno's already convinced that you're actually the legitimate Clendon. Yeah. And he's like, "All right, good, I have backup now." And he looks over at Vigdis and he goes, "Yeah, look who I've got."
Yeah, you've got a soon to be bleeding throat. Oh dear Lord.
The longer I play Arno, the worse I feel for him.
Yes. Yes.
Now we know why he became a town drunk.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, really. He was a really bad mercenary.
6 plus 1. I will hit him, or does 15 hit?
15 actually does not.
Oh, then I do not hit.
He has mail and a large shield.
And you don't get an extra boon from now.
All right, so that was that turn. So like, man, I gotta see now. I'm rolling to see how dense he is. Okay, he noticed that you hit him. But, hey now, you're not getting an extra cut by cutting me out of it. This is a bad time to double cross someone. So, he doesn't necessarily think you're not Clendon. He just thinks that you're trying to double cross him. Thank you. So, third round, we're starting with fast turns.
Well, I want to, Arno again.
All right.
So, following on what he said last turn, he yells out, "You are the smaller man!" That is a little 27.
Okay, yeah, that hits.
See if we squeeze. Only 7 points of damage this time.
Ah. Arno is still not out. He's tough, he's just not smart.
Wow.
All right.
I will take a fast turn.
Okay.
I'm just going to try to stab him again.
All right.
Ah, 14. Jesus.
Listen, we can renegotiate later, but quit stabbing me.
Here, I'll finish him off. There you go, 23.
Nice. Yeah.
So it's over 20 again, so that's 3 dice of damage.
Wow.
So that's only 7, 9.
That is enough to take Arno out. So you were using a sword.
Are you
sword,
killing
right?
him or are you subduing him?
Arno's like a villain of ours, but I mean, we have to let him show up again, so I'll knock him out.
Okay. So
he'll be even more powerful next time.
Knowing Arno's luck, I'm going to roll the die just to see. So this is what came up on the that came up on the die. So. So you attempt to subdue him, and you're thinking like, I'm just gonna hit him with the flat of the blade, and you smack him with the flat of the blade, and he like spins around, and as he spins around, his neck like just like cuts right along your blade, essentially like his bad luck slit his own throat.
I'm not torn up by it.
Oh,
disappointed.
So now we have a robot and a dead dwarf.
And a tied up.
We have to deal with
Clendon.
Like yes, in the movie version of this, we see a very brief moment where like Vig just kind of looks at him, and then we see a montage of all the times that Arno was a total asshole in that brothel. I've been spilling things over, starting fights and stuff like that. And he collapses around and dies.
So the clockwork looks at you guys and goes, you know, if you wanted to set me free, I can go back to the city and look for more work that doesn't involve questionable things. Because, you know, I'm not a questionable guy. Not what I do. Really. I mean, I stab things and kill them, but I'm kind of straightforward about stabbing people and killing them.
Vignus's two cents are... We don't gift life, we sell it.
Well, Kane will do last rites over Arno.
Yeah, that's actually what Abby's thinking. I think we should bury Arno. Whether or not he's an enemy or not, it's a bad idea for him to be left to rot out in the sun.
I'm just going to throw this out here. Not that I would have done it, but my first thought was when you were saying – we can leave him alive, he can be a recurring villain, and I'm thinking in this setting, I could still make him a recurring villain even if you kill him.
Well, I'm not that knowledgeable.
All right, given that you guys wanted to perform last rites on him, yeah, this is, you know.
Well, fringes of the mind, that'd be faster and easier just to burn his body. Just drag him to the middle of the road, light it up.
After we strip it of, I'm guessing after we strip it of that fancy new armor and shield.
Yeah, yeah, he's got mail and a shield and a sword.
That would fit Kane, or could be resized to fit Kane.
I have armor.
Do you have mail though?
I didn't go for mail because I have the same. I have the same defense regardless. So.
Oh, okay.
And I wouldn't have the negatives of mail. And I may not be strong enough for mail either. I don't remember.
Okay. Abby is definitely not. but yeah, it's definitely worth keeping to sell. That's for sure.
Well, we can put it on his horse.
We've got a cart.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And we have an extra horse now.
Yeah, well, now we just could put a foot on two different horses.
We also have Clendon. Poor Clendon, whom Abby will attempt medicine. She's not using magic on this guy.
Okay.
She will use a use out of the healer's kit that she has. Right. Not the one that she bought for her downtime, but the one that she uses for in-game. And that's a one. So she fails.
All right. So Clendon is still out. So basically, Gearbox is over there gone. Can I just go? Because I mean, I wasn't really with these guys. I was just with these guys.
Just out of curiosity, if I were to.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
No, that was my immediate question. I'm sorry, Mike.
Well, go ahead with the thing. I'll ask after he answers. I don't want to ruin that. Or can I ask now? If I were to kill a medium-sized clockwork, how much would their body be worth in parts? I'm just saying, if it's like 20 gold walking around, you know.
Not that much. I'm saying it's probably more silver. Because, I mean, it's not like... This isn't like the construct that you guys saw last time that was, like, all plated and had bronze on it and everything. This is just, like, you know, metal and iron and pieces like that. But, you know, I would probably roll a D6 and give you that many silver for...
Well, if you were going to craft a clockwork body of medium size, it'd be 100 gold coins worth.
Yeah.
See, that's what I'm talking about.
Now, used clockwork, probably less.
Yeah.
Sure, but yeah. I mean, you know.
Well, because part of building the clockwork's body is doing all the little symbols that are going to trap the soul and all that stuff, too. So, I mean.
And once you destroy that, then it's worth less. So Jeff, who hired you?
Hey, I just know. And you know, Jeff could have been my name. I don't remember because, you know, I'm just a soul that's been through transition. It's been a rough transition, but it's been a transition. And you see, we got hired by some ritzy types that said they were keeping an eye on Mother Bastion because she speaks in Uki language. And and they don't trust her now, and they heard that she wanted you guys to go find somebody, and they figured if she wants to find him, it's got to be important. So all these rich guys that are like nobles that came from the Empire when the Empire got, you know, harshed by all the orcs, they came here, and they decided that they're going to set up shop, and they're going to set up like a shadow government. And when they set up this shadow government, they want to make sure they got people in their pockets, and they want to know who they can put in their pocket that Mother Bastion was looking for. So they hired us to follow you to find your way to find whoever they were finding so that we can bring them back to them. You follow?
I do follow. We need some introductions though.
I'm just kind of the middleman because I was in a bar that Arno likes to go to. And Arno said, "We need you. You look intimidating." I said, "Oh, I'm just built that way." And
our poor unconscious friend also worked with Arno with these nobles, right?
Yeah, that's because he had connections, because he used to work for the church, and then he had like some accident where he fell down some stairs. That seems like a really seems like a really shitty way to lose your job, but apparently he fell down some stairs, so they fired him.
Yes, and we're very sorry about that.
Yeah, I mean, I feel bad for it too. I mean, just fall down some stairs and lose your job, that's terrible.
No, I mean, we are very sorry about that, aren't we, Vigdis?
Vigdis sort of like looks down like a child caught doing something wrong.
Oh man.
So actually, you know, given that you like stabbing things, and there's the potential of bad things about to happen, I don't really trust you, but you also have a sword.
Well, yeah, I do.
Now, you don't intend on killing us in our sleep, do you?
No.
does this guy have the expert past the dude?
Yes, that's the question.
Novice path, thank you.
No, I wouldn't. Hey, why would I? I wouldn't. No.
I mean, seriously, I mean, if we're going somewhere where there's the potential of Fae having an extra sword or, you know, an extra, gear shield rather than meat shield, an extra, you know, body here that we can throw in front of, you know, us and Vigdis, to potentially save us. I'm metagaming here. obviously. I'm thinking, an extra sword wouldn't be a bad thing, but given that the others wanted to effectively stab us in the back, and this guy is being more upfront with us than the other two were.
Tugs on Abby's robe and sort of like gestures for her to come over.
Okay.
And he says Abby, there is a Jotun saying, you can't purchase part of the ocean. And he says that as if like you should understand what that means.
She just looks at him like, what?
But he tries to gesture like that if you purchase something and it's moving away, then you've just wasted your money on something. What he's trying to imply, and in the time that you've dealt with him with his like idiotic Jotun adages, I'm thinking you've sort of like, oh, okay. What he's effectively trying to say is that like this guy didn't say bought the first time he was purchased, so why would we think he's going to stay bought this time?
Good point. Good point. So here's the other problem is that we have now the injured, this poor guard that we've now taken out twice. That robot here should take back to town and have my worry is robot's going to turn us into the authorities and tell them that we are trying to kill people on the road as bandits.
He can say anything he wants. It doesn't mean it's true.
Yeah.
Yes, but if poor guard boy here backs it up and then we come back into town on a cart.
We certainly didn't kill them.
This is a good point.
Yeah, man. I just need to like get back home because I kind of miss home. Home is where I belong. And home, apparently, as I have learned since I left home, home was apparently sitting on the floor in the bar.
Well, that's probably a safe place for you. Can you, so how much would a doctor cost in town? Like just somebody to do.
You want a good one? Huh? Do you want a good one or someone to, you know, like poke someone with something sharp and put leeches on them?
Well, given that we've already sent this guy down the stairs a couple of times, I'm going to say poke him a couple of times with something sharp and use some leeches.
I was going to say a silver piece would probably get them to at least take a look at the guy.
All right. So if I I look at the guy that I've tied up with my rope, mm-hmm. and I say, I look at Robot, and I say, "All right," and I hope this is okay with everybody else. But can you take this guy back to town and get him a doctor? Okay. I will pay for the doctor.
Okay.
And then we never met. We don't talk ever again. And if we see you again, we end you.
Hey, that's cool, because I don't know you, lady.
So I think Vigdis will step forward, like, without saying anything, and he'll just reach down and pull that guy's sword out of his scabbard.
Okay.
Step back and just stand there like, all right, on your way.
And Abby will take out a silver shilling and hand the robot the silver shilling.
So he goes, all right, so just to be clear, I don't know you. We don't know you. I take him back to town, drop him off as a doctor, and I don't use this to buy any dream grease, and I actually give this to the doctor to pay for him to get taken care of. That yes. is the plan.
Yes.
Yeah, we're going to find this guy in a ditch on the way home.
All right, I will follow the plan as I have detailed it to you. That is exactly what I will do.
Am I, did I overstep on anybody here?
Nope. Fine.
I don't know why we had to pay him to get beat up by us, though. That seems a little weird.
Okay.
Yeah, like, we could have walked away.
Abby has this weird sense of morality about this poor guard. We cost him his job. And Abby just made him have to get new clothes on top of it all.
And Gearbox is totally not going to spend that overshilling on that dream grease.
At least, you know, by the time they get far enough, away from us, it's not going to be a horrible thing. And now Vigdis's enemy is now dead.
Mm.
Yeah, that is true.
And we've performed last rites on him, so.
All that right.
Probably kills an extra day, though.
So your rival adventuring band no longer exists. It has been disbanded. And unless you guys have something specific you would like to do at Midkeep, I'm going to assume that you just stop there briefly and keep moving.
Fresh water. That's it.
Yep. Yeah, just your general reprovisioning, not like talking to anybody or anything like that. So nope. You stop it.
We could sell off Arno's horse.
Yeah, we could sell off the horse and the mail and the swords.
Okay. Just to make it quick, if you want half value for those, you can do that.
Okay.
They're always willing to get more mail and horses here at Midkeep, since, you know, they have to patrol for beastmen that are wandering the wilderness.
Horses so and silly.
When you get about a day away from Midkeep, on the other side, Ryan!
Yes.
You spy this party. How would you like to introduce yourself? Actually, I'm going to tell you this because everybody will, you know, you'll be in the party. We're going to assume, not that I worry about this with this group, but because it's happened with other groups, we're going to assume eventually you will all work together. You will not murder the new party member that shows up because this is not the DCC session where we went through four party members in one session because people kept murdering new people.
They've got nice new gear. I've heard this story.
Yeah, that happened. So, you see them. You were actually aware of what the other elves were doing. They were concerned that the bishop had learned something worthwhile about the three witches. They really wanted to know what the three witches know about the troll spell. So they were going to take the bishop and offer him as payment to a representative of the three witches to find out what they knew about the troll spell. And that's where the elves went. You got separated from them, so you know all of that, and you see them now here. And you have not heard back from the other elves afraid something bad has happened to them. And you see them making their camp the second day. They're about a day away from their final goal. So what do you do?
Well, I am curious about the world beyond my home and seeking new experiences among the fascinating creatures there. So I'm going to go say hi. But they may be hostile, so I'm going to make sure I have my item of power, which in my case is a grotesque human human face mask painted in arcane symbols on.
Nice.
And he's going to wander over to the camp. So a, 850-year-old elf with he appears to be made of golden branches with a crown of golden twigs and raven feather hair comes up to the camp.
With a mask on, made out of a human face.
Yes. With all sorts of arcane symbols over it.
At this point, Vigdis is, I think, taking care of... So Arno, clearly because he was such a dick, was fucking horrible to that horse. So Vigdis is carefully grooming the horse, who he has...
No, we sold the horse in Midkeep. You're taking care of Harold.
Oh, did we? Okay.
Yeah, we sold Arno's horse in Midkeep after you took care of it that night, so...
Okay. Yep.
Sorry.
Little tears running down Vigdis' cheek, saying, yeah, it'll be a better life, Solvig.
probably true.
So the exotic elf walks into camp here. And
he's also wearing soft leather armor. He's got a bronze dagger, a bone cutlass, a bow, and some arrows and the like. And a really nice cloak.
Do you have a weapon drawn?
Nope.
Okay.
Just a human skin face mask.
You guys don't know it's human skin face.
Oh no, it's a human face.
Yeah, I know, but it could just be skillfully rendered leather, you know.
That's not creepy at all. Do we gain insanity by looking at the mask?
No, he's a party member. You intrinsically feel he's a party member. You do not gain sanity from this.
Okay. All right, well, we'll hail this newcomer. Tell us your story. Why'd you come to our camp? Do we need to kill you?
At the moment.
How much is you're carrying worth?
Start with the last one, which is, no, you don't need to kill me. Well, it's just been a while since I've seen a fully grown human. The last one I tried to grow, I don't know. It ended up somewhere. So what brings you out here?
We
Yes, I understand many mortals lose their ability to speak when presented with one of my fair race.
I will be able to hear you. I'm going to put the dog out real quick, but I will be able to hear.
Even the GM's bored with us.
As you guys are talking, some birds like land on his shoulders and just start chirping, and he kind of just absently waves them away.
Do you know of any elves kidnapping a human recently?
Well, yes.
What do you know of the elves kidnapping a human recently?
Oh, well, he was trying to find information about a thing, and we're worried that he did, so we're going to trade him for more information.
All right, well, where is he?
Screaming Forest.
So yeah, wherever the elf points, it's pretty much the same direction that the compass is pointing already.
Is he friend of yours?
Yes.
A peer.
Huh.
Vigdis says a bounty.
Oh, okay. So I don't need to contemplate using you guys to get more information. Okay.
What is your name?
As long as you're hunting them too. Widow's Cry.
Sweet. Say again?
Widow's Cry.
Widow's Cry.
cry, not widows. Scry. So,
yeah.
It's a great story. When I took the human that I was going to raise and then misplaced, I also decided that the male human had a very striking face, and I was working on becoming a magician. So I went ahead and took that amazing face of his, so that I could, you know, build my ability to do magic. And as all this was going on, the female human was making this beautiful crying sound, and thinking about it just makes me happy. So, you can call me Widow's Cry.
They just does one of those, like, slow, speechless, kind of, like, turns to Abby and turns back to Widow's Cry.
More birds land on his shoulders. He kind of waves them away.
And,
sorry, it's the thing that I rolled.
Also, Widow's Cry knows that... I need to make a card for you. Widow's Cry knows that the troll spell is... You don't know exactly the details of it, which is a problem, but the troll spell is something that is supposed to bring about the end of the world, as the trolls were basically saying, screw you elves, if we can't win, then we'll just trash everything.
Mm.
So that is, you know a little bit more about the troll spell, just not exactly how it works or what triggers it or anything like that.
And is that what the bishop was trying to find information about, this like final sanction?
It was something that was, that was mentioned in some of the stuff that you went through in his quarters. And the elf was the elf that he was torturing was talking about.
So Vegas, I guess, says Gotendamerung.
The elf will stare at him for a long time. You don't look trollish.
Does he say that in trollish?
No.
Can you show us where the human is or was taken?
The other elves were taking him to the witches.
Yeah, can you take us there?
Sure.
So, are you guys going to head out in that direction?
Once we attack everything, yes.
Okay. As you're getting closer to this location, you're getting just out in the outer edges of the Screaming Forest, and the compass is pointing this way, the elf is directing you this way. You see, nailed up on various trees, there are dead elves that have been killed and dismembered in very creative fashions. And not only have they been killed and dismembered, but they've been posed in various disturbing ways. I will leave this to your imagination, but there are lots of interesting and various combinations of how the elves were murdered and put back together in different poses and such. So,
Widow's Cry will nod and appreciate the artistry.
Yeah, I was going to say, if everyone could give me a will challenge roll, everyone will take one bane to this except the elf. The elf can just make this roll straight.
My insanity.
I was curious, how do you pose? How do you pose people if they've been dismembered? Isn't it all the same? I mean, you just put their trunk in different directions, or
oh no, not at all. You can take the fingers and put them in different places, and he'll wax eloquent about how to properly pose dismembered bodies.
It's like the Bill Burrows cut up method.
Oh, that's just not right.
Yeah, I didn't succeed at all.
All right, Kane failed as well. This is pretty bizarre.
Jared, I have thank God I have your actual phone number, because you're getting a text message of exactly what I rolled. this is ridiculous. I wish I could tell you anything other than that.
All of you that don't have dice that are celestially aligned.
Mine are celestially aligned. Yes, it's the red die and the red skull die.
You are all taking a point of insanity.
Nice.
Widow's Cry rolled a 13.
Yeah, that doesn't bother you. It's like you're kind of upset that it's elves, but I mean,
meh.
If it wasn't elves, you know.
So yeah, that was I did not fail.
To go over and readjust some pieces that clearly the wind or a passing animal has knocked slightly out of alignment.
This should have been this way. Yeah, if Widow's Cry does this for too much longer, people might have to take another
another sanity. He's an artist. His subcategory is painter, but still, he is an artist among many, many other things.
How did Fringe do on the...
Oh, she failed him to 3 now.
Okay.
Oh.
So Clendon will start babbling, and this time his face will start to take on different features before it finally settles down back to Clendon.
Like one eye gets bigger than the other one for a minute.
Yeah.
The Widow's Cry will start contemplating Fringe. Trying to figure out if Fringe is the human child he lost. I'm sorry, not lost. Misplaced.
Yeah.
Entirely possible.
You come up to you see in the distance there's a clearing and there is a campfire.
Oh dear.
And there appears to be a cage of some sort. And there is a man that looks very haggard and old. He's not wearing clothing, which is uncomfortable in this particular time of year, but the fire is probably at least keeping him from freezing to death. And next to him is this thing. It's over 9 feet tall. It's very fat. It's got like this impossibly wide mouth. It's generally humanoid, but it's just this big mass of fat and muscle. And it's sitting there by the camp, and it's kind of talking to itself, going, "The sister said I should feed you, because you would be great bait. So I will feed you." And he cuts like a finger off of like this elf that he's got, you know, this elf's body that he's got there, and he throws the finger at the guy, and the guy just kind of like recoils from it. "Oh well, more for me." And he starts chewing on the arm.
Do any of us have any idea what this creature is?
Is it a natural creature of some sort?
Well, I was going to say the elf probably, well, it's the Jotun probably knows too. The elf and the Jotun, this is an ogre. Ogres, special ability in this setting. If there is a defenseless or dead creature that is size 1 or smaller, they can eat it as an action. They're really good at that stuff.
So Vignus leans into Abby and says, "I do not like the screaming forest."
I'm with you, Vignus.
We say the human was the bishop or no?
You can make a perception challenge roll to see.
No, I don't know.
11.
Okay, yeah, so Abby...
Less than 1.
Since I don't know if Vignus ever paid enough attention to really realize what the bishop looked like anyway, but Abby, yeah, you can make out that it's a bishop, but he really doesn't look like himself. He's lost weight. He's, you know, his hair is long and scraggly, and he's unkempt, and he looks like he's in really bad shape.
Widow's Cry, these are his companions.
This is the bishop for sure.
Yeah, Widow's Cry, these are parts of your companions, it looks like.
This is unfortunate.
Although, what did the ogre said that he should be fed by who?
Sisters.
The sisters. Yeah.
And then he'd be bait. For who? For us or for someone else?
For us. This is a setup for a trap of some sort.
Right, let's send Fringe to look around.
Yeah. What else is in the what else is in the area?
Like that. Fringe, go scout. Oh man. In this general area, you just see there's a couple like woodland paths leading through here, and there's this clearing, but you're getting really close to getting further into the Forest of Screams. Essentially, this area, if you were to get into combat, would be the edge of the forest is behind you. This is the forest clearing, and the deep, dark woods are beyond. So those would be your three areas in this particular region.
Okay. So we could get to this thing in one round.
Oh, yeah.
Like, get it in attack. Okay.
Or those
so Vigdis is looking to Kane for direction, I think.
I mean, I've got my bow, which I could start firing on the ogre in one round.
Yep.
Yeah, you could draw him to us where we could ambush it.
There's no reason for us really not to. It's possible it's a trap, but I think we're gonna have to. Sometimes the best way to do a trap is just to spring it.
I can probably lure it somewhere with my cunning.
I was thinking, well, if I shoot it with an arrow, it would probably come to us.
Yeah, but then I'd be ready to fight, right?
Yes, but if we trip it on its way to getting to me, like tie like a rope, do the whole rope on the ground, and as it runs, you guys pull it tight. Because it's an ogre, it still might be dumb.
Or you could rig two logs to come down and.
No, I don't think we have time for that one.
It all sounds possible, but I think we can just deal with it the old-fashioned way.
You know, I knew I should have taken a profession of Ewok engineering.
Kane will draw his sword in motion for Vigdis to approach the ogre with him.
He's by approach, do you mean like approach or like approach?
He has a sword out and he's going towards him. That was his plan.
So you guys are going to try and close the area distance there. Abby is going to shoot from here. Fringe, are you going to like hide out in the?
Yeah, I will get off my horse and hide in the shrubbery.
Okay. And Widow's Cry, what would you like to do?
I want to be within short range, though. I just want to be clear about that.
Okay.
He's going to prepare to cast Misdirect.
Okay. All right. So we will start then with a is anyone going to take a fast turn? Abby, you could shoot on a fast turn.
Will that give the others time to attack? Will they be able to take their fast turns to attack the ogre?
No, because they're going to need to take a slow turn to close on him.
Yeah, I need a slow.
Okay. On the ogre, that would mean the ogre would also need a slow turn, so we're okay if I shoot them.
Sure.
All right. All right. Jared, I'm going to go with celestially aligned dice today. I'm going to go get a different set of D20s.
This is like the opposite of Ryan rolling in the Thursday night game.
Jared, I'm sitting here and I'm rolling and I'm changing. I've got four D20s in front of me.
It's all right because eventually it'll catch up to you. Don't worry.
Yes, you know it will catch up to me, but I don't want it to be. I don't want it to be my poor Council of Thieves character.
That's all right.
Catch up with me.
That's all right. But anyway, did you shoot him? I'm assuming.
He might be grabbing dice.
Okay.
You said he was going to go grab different dice.
Do I have to move to get a shot, or can I spend a slow turn to try and hide and then get a boom on my shot?
Yeah, you're probably going to have to do a slow turn to be able to hide and then...
Okay, then I will wait for slow.
Okay.
Widow is going to cast Misdirect at it.
Okay.
Nice. What is the ogre's perception?
The ogre's is a whopping 7. Which is why he was talking about a trap right in front of you.
So I can beat that with an 8. So he will be at a bane for making attack rolls as long as he's within short range of me for 1 minute.
All right.
That's awesome.
So the ogre has an extra bane because he was distracted by the elf.
Yep.
Because of the elfness. And I guess we will have Abby take her shot whenever
Abby. Yeah, I think Steve dropped. Steve's having Steve internet again. Issues, maybe.
Dun, dun, dun.
I keep doing like the official sending an invite thing just because I figure it's easier to find. Because I don't know what's going on with that today. Got a message from Steve. Okay, that was not it. Okay. So
I'm back.
There he is. Okay. Would you
I was sending pictures of what I was rolling to.
Yeah, I saw that.
You see why I'm like, I'm to the point where I don't believe what I'm rolling.
It's okay, Steve. It's okay. How much did you shot him with an arrow, correct?
Yep, and the arrow does a d6, so the gopher die was a 5.
All right. So, the ogre is standing there in the clearing, and he like starts seeing people like moving towards him, and he's like, ha ha, the trap is sprung, and then the arrow like shoots him in the ear, and he's like, ow, the trap hurts. And he's like, what is that buzzing noise? None of you hear the buzzing noise. That buzzing noise is so distracting. I must crush everything that makes noise. So that is so Widow's Cry and Abigail took fast turns. And the ogre is not going to take a fast turn because nothing is within its reach to crush. So slow turns. So Fringe, you can hide and shoot if you wish and all the other stuff here.
Fringe will, do I have to roll to hide? I assume, yes.
Yeah, if you don't want him to notice exactly where you're at.
D20 plus one, hide. I fail at that entirely.
Okay, so you're obvious, but you can still, you know.
Yeah. I'll still trickery him.
Okay.
And hopefully hit. 14.
A 14 misses. What were you using?
A hand crossbow.
Ah, so the dart like bounces off of its thick blubbery skin. So Kane and Vigdis, what would you guys like to do?
Kane, you go ahead.
I'm gonna sneeze, go ahead.
Okay. All right, so Vigdis goes charging to this thing and once again screaming out his trollish call of dibs. 20. So that's a 26.
All right, that hits him.
And he takes 6 points of damage.
All right.
Use my triggered action to try and goad him.
Okay.
Polish, he says, come try and slay me, beast. His intellect is not that high, so it's like, come get me.
Yeah. Me. Yeah.
So right. I rolled a 7 against his will.
Yeah, okay. Oh, you rolled a...
I don't know if that...
His will is slightly higher than his intellect.
God damn it.
But
okay, so yeah, he doesn't have to attack me. He doesn't take a bane on attacking other people then.
He also, which means if he attacks like anybody else but you, it would be 2 banes. But he uses his triggered action to vomit up the elf that he just ate. Because that is his
awesome.
Vomit is his triggered action. Okay, so he sprays you with... you must make an agility challenge roll.
Oh, because my agility's on. Actually, my agility's not that bad. Okay, let's see here. Come on. Yes, 16. So.
All right. So you will only take half damage, and you are not impaired.
Nice. It's not the first time I've had a troll puke on me.
So, or ogre. So you take 3 points of damage from the violent ejection of fluid and elf bone shards hitting you.
Sorry, how much? 5?
3.
3. Okay, sorry.
That is disgusting. Abby's glad to be using the ranged weapons.
He just bellows out, just like Arno.
Okay, he can't vomit again until he eats something else. So,
all right, so I can attack here with my sword. So I can attack, yes.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
So I'm not going to do too well this time. Oh, an 8. Oof.
That does not hit him.
Son of a gun! I must be sliding on all the elf juice.
Yeah,
I think you can. Yeah, you can blame Vigdis because his effort to try and get out of the way of the vomit could have knocked you off.
Ew.
All right. The ogre gets an actual turn now, and he's going to take a bane from being distracted because of the elf. And his attack is normally with one boon, so he's just even. And I think he's going to go ahead and attack the, even though, you know, the challenge wasn't as spectacular as it could have been, you know, a guy that's almost the same height as him kind of makes sense to hit him first. So
love it.
So he swings at you. Oh, holy crap. I'm assuming a 25 hits.
It does hit. Yeah.
Oh.
Did you include his bane from me?
Yeah. Yeah, he gets plus 5 to hit, plus 1 boon, so he's plus 5 to hit without the...
Okay.
So, damage. Oh, that's nothing. That was only 7.
Okay. As he, smashes... Does he have a weapon, or is he using his claws?
He's got a big spiked club.
Okay, so as that thing hits my shield, I shout out in trollish, "You're weak!"
Ugh. I'm not weak. I just need to eat more.
Oh, that's not good.
So, that is everybody for the first turn. Now we go into the second turn.
Fast turn and for Vigdis.
The first thing, actually, not we don't know because there is an end of round thing that happens this turn. And the end of round turn that happens is out in the distance at the... into the deep dark forest section of the areas, all of you see what appears to be a ramshackle hut with two giant skeletal clawed legs underneath it. And the hut
walks. Keanu Reeves.
Yeah. The hut walks into the clearing, and all of you now, when you see this, must make a test against it being terrifying. So, and that is with one bane.
Okay. This ain't gonna be good. Nope.
Is it a will?
Just feel bad.
Yes, it is a will check.
I got A1.
Okay.
Ooh, made it.
I've made it.
Okay. So
the elf did not.
Okay. So those of you that fail because it's terrifying, you all take a point of sanity damage.
Three.
Okay.
And everyone that failed is also frightened. So you make all attack and challenge rolls with one bane, and you cannot take fast turns.
Okay.
So the hut walked into the clearing at the end of this turn, and now we start the next turn. So anyone that can and is willing to take a fast turn may do so now.
You just will take slow now.
I'm going to take a fast turn. I'll just attack this ogre.
Okay.
I'm going to take a slow turn. So, no, I'm going to.
Okay.
I have
to. Oh, I missed again. I cannot hit now. Oh, boy. We used all of our good rolls against the NPC party.
Yeah.
So- I still have the blessed dice. I'm still texting Jared my dice rolls.
So you continue to slip on elf regurgitation as you attempt to attack the ogre.
Yeah. Boots steaming from the bile of the ogre.
All right. So that was that. I think on the ogre is going to take a since nobody else is going to take a fast turn. Correct.
Correct.
Right.
The ogre is going to take a fast turn and attempt to wallop the he looks at the Jotun and goes,
You look scared now. You see my big boss, which is good because now you are scared, and I will prove myself to my big boss by crushing your head in because my big boss is here and you are scared.
Vigdis has a retort, but he's going to have to wait till his turn.
So does a 15 hit Vigdis?
It does not.
All right.
So the fires off my shield.
The big spike club comes down and you deflect it with your shield, and he goes, "Stop using shield! That is cheating." So that is the ogre's turn, and now we're into slow turns.
Abby's going to hate herself in the morning. Okay. Abby is going to walk into the clearing and cast ecstasy on the ogre.
Oh god. Oh.
If there's a triggered attack that comes from this, that's really going to be unfortunate for Vigdis.
Well, the good news is that it wasn't another 20, which, thank God. But it was a 16 on the roll, so 18 on the 18 on it, the die, or 18 total. So he's dazed for one round and slowed for one round after.
Love it.
So yeah, next turn he cannot use actions, and yeah. I will not provide full details of doing damage to everybody. But the ogre is only wearing a loincloth. Draw from that what you will. You see the effects of the spell. He's got this really stupid look on his face right now. So, anyone else with slow turns?
Yep, Vigdis will, he sort of laughs, he laughs. Who is foolish now? See, oh, hold on, like, yeah, no Boon or Bane, but I did roll an 18, so it's a 22 to hit.
All right.
Oops. And let's see here. Fuck. 7 points of damage.
All right. Well, the ogre is still, you know, you hit him hard, but I mean, with all of the blubbery, leathery flesh, it doesn't, you know, fell him by any means, but you definitely cut into the skin and he is injured by this.
And I'm going to use my trigger action to catch my breath. Okay. So my health is back up to 20 now.
Nice. All right, other slow actions?
I guess I'd shoot an arrow at him.
All right.
That's a natural 20.
Nice.
Does that with I haven't used a weapon in this game. Does that add additional damage?
Only if you have certain talents.
Okay.
It's not an automatic.
So 6 points.
All right.
He was provided with a large target on the ogre, and so he shot it and did lots of damage.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Because that would be far the most interesting experience that he could have in this fight, is to see how would an ogre react to this.
The ogre, when the arrow strikes that close to the target that you were targeting, he gets this really odd look on his face, like he can't quite decide how that felt. So, yeah, again, I will leave it at that. Fringe, what would you like to do?
Is that to me? I'm sorry?
Yes.
Yes.
I cannot hide and shoot on a slow turn, right? Just hide or shoot?
Hiding is an action, I believe, because it's using a skill. All
right. And there's a hut and an ogre.
Yes.
I'm going to shoot at the hut, I think.
Okay.
That's a bad idea. But okay. Go for it.
I've been playing too much Star Wars because I heard H-U-T-T.
In both cases, it's a bad idea to shoot at a hut.
Yeah.
I'm sitting here, I'm going, oh, well, no, it's Baba Yaga. Like
Baba Yaga, yeah, Baba Yaga's hut. Yeah. Chicken legs and everything?
Yep. Well, in this case, they're skeletal clawed legs, but yeah, it's a hut with legs.
Yeah, I'm going to shoot at that thing. I'm not getting eaten by that thing. I don't want
to. Okay.
I got a 20 on the dot.
Yeah, that hits the you hit the broadside of the hut.
They can have 6 points of damage.
All right.
Watch out.
So you hear a satisfying thunk as the arrow sinks into the front porch. And
take that, planter.
So as you shoot it, and then on its slow turn, the hut moves from the deep, dark woods to the edge of the clearing. So it's in the same area as the rest of you guys are now.
Yeah, this is not cool at all.
So, next turn, third turn.
What is the bishop doing during this time?
Whimpering. He is kind of a wreck of his former self. You're not sure if it's because of the ogre or the elves that kidnapped him, but he is not forming coherent words at this point. He's just kind of like shivering up against the cage. So anyone that can take turns, you may do so now.
Frightened last.
Jared?
Yes.
How long does the frightened last?
The frightened lasts for, sorry. One second, I am sorry. It lasts until you die of a heart attack. No.
Awesome.
Not the real answer.
Vigdis has a quite fat, heavy diet, so. His cardiac health score is terrible.
Yeah. Well.
Okay, so it is frightened lasts for two rounds. It's 1d3, so two rounds plus your insanity total.
Okay. So, okay. Future for me.
I did roll an attack. I did a fast attack. I was muted, so you didn't hear me talking about it, but I missed. I think I got a 12.
I am really sorry that the ogre is not the showcase for your talents.
Certainly not this time. I'll get
him. Even with him dazed, he doesn't have any sort of penalty from being dazed.
What's that?
He doesn't have any penalty from being dazed.
He just can't take actions.
Oh, well, hey, that's still better than him swinging at us.
That's true.
That's right.
So, yes, I'm going to go ahead and mark him as taking his action since he can't take his action. But, yeah, apparently you just wanted to school a bunch of mercenaries, and now that you're up against an ogre, you're like, nobody expects me to hit them.
It certainly hasn't been in my training.
Abigail's the only other one that can take a fast action, correct?
Abby is the only one that can take a fast action, so she is... She can't open the cage. That's the problem. What's the cage made out of?
It's actually just kind of woven together, you know, like twigs and things of that nature.
So like if I had...
almost like weird, scary witches in the woods like to build things out of twigs being woven together.
Yeah.
Amateurs. They learned it from elves.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think of a way to break that up or tear it apart. Like, would I be able to like cut it open with like a knife?
Yeah, probably. I mean, it's reinforced because there's like bundles of twigs, you know, together, but if you were cutting it, you'd be cutting each twig individually.
So if I like took a slow action, would I be able to like help cut open the cage?
Yeah, you could walk up to it and start taking an action to hack it open.
That is what I'm going to do. I am not combat monkey.
Okay. Cool. All right then. So then we go to slow turns. Who would like to take their
slow turn? To combat monkeys.
Hey, Vigdis.
Vigdis is going to try and hit this thing. He says again, "You are weak." So 22 again.
That hits.
Colored.
And right now you're like, saying you're telling him that he's weak and hitting him, and he's just kind of laughing because he's still kind of giggling in his euphoric state.
Yeah. He probably enjoys it. Only 5 points of damage.
Okay.
Weak as well.
The ogre has not dropped yet, but he is bleeding from several places, and maybe even some bones look like they're not in the right place, but he doesn't seem to care at the moment.
So I think this isn't what he wants from this, so he sort of looks to Kane as if to like get direction.
Kane is so busy slipping around, he can't help. This is not the best footing for fighting.
So Fringe, what would you like to do? Are you continuing your crusade against the house?
Yeah.
Extreme home makeover.
I don't want to get
out of the demon house style.
And I would have. Okay. So, and I'm suffering a bane from frightened. So
yes.
My trickery. Got it. So 18.
18 hits the house.
Yeah. I hope I kill this house. 10 points.
Oh, this is gonna go so poorly.
Yeah, I'm just, I had to look up what a structure's hit points would be because, you know, I want to make sure. But yeah, I have a total going. You hit the house, you do a little bit more damage. You knock the front porch swing off.
Well, they can't be all bad. They have a porch swing.
So, Widow's Cry and Abigail, what would you guys like to do?
I'm cutting the cage.
Okay, so Abigail, give me, you don't have to make a check for this, but just tell me how much damage you do.
All right, dagger, and I do all of 2 points of damage.
Okay, so you're not quite through it yet. You're cutting some away, but it's not enough to get him out of it yet.
Okay.
And Widow's Cry.
Widow's Cry is going to mount the house. And from the elevated position of the front porch, go, "Hey, ogre, I'm going to knock on the door and show your bosses just how bad a job you're doing. You should stop me." That big club of yours.
Oh, man. So you're just walking over to the house and threatening to knock on the door.
And taunting the ogre, hoping that he will decide to attack me.
Okay.
Or at me, and more particularly, the house.
Okay, so you're positioning yourself so that his strike could go wild and hit the house.
Oh, yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. So that's it for that turn, because the ogre doesn't get to do anything this turn. And so now we start with a fast turn, or the fourth round, I think. So who that can take a fast turn would like to?
Still not yet.
I can. I will.
Kill it.
Yeah.
Kill it.
Nope. This is all I've rolled for like the last four times in a row. So
no, actually, what I was gonna say is I'm saying that you know Steve's rolling is gonna catch up with him, but I think in cosmic balance, Steve's roll is actually throwing your rolls off.
I'll have fortune too.
Yeah, you all have fortune.
I'm waiting to see what happens with the bosses for that.
All right. So that was Kane. Abigail, you can take a fast action. Would you like to take a fast action to keep sawing at the bishops? Yep.
Hello.
Okay, so it's not critical if you take a fast action or a slow action for it. So we will, and actually the ogre now, I think the ogre is dumb enough to do this, where he's going to try and stop the elf from knocking on the front door.
Let's do a triggered action.
So he's going to have, yes, he's going to have two banes for this. And on top of having two banes for this, I'm going to say, this is going to be one of those special circumstances where if he gets a total that is zero or less, he's actually going to hit the house.
Um, you can have what, up to three? You can have up to three Banes.
I don't think there's a limit.
Well, how many count?
No, just one. It's just the highest one.
Ah. Well, anyway, when he swings at me, triggered action to pop Celerity and be standing on the other side of the porch. So there's not even a me in between, and he doesn't get free actions because of Celerity.
Okay. So if you do that, I am actually going to say if he misses at all. If he hits, he would have hit you. If he misses, he definitely hits the house. So that brings him to a grand total of 10.
My defense is 12.
Yeah, so he would not have hit you, so he solidly hits the house with the club. So, the club does not destroy the house. I know you guys were... But, yes, he crashes through one of the windows in the house. Nice. With the club.
Oh, you did it now.
that was his turn there.
Uh-oh.
So that was fast. Who would like to take a slow turn?
Vigus would. Yeah, I'm going to try and bean this guy again. Vigus laughs and says, "You are weak and stupid." Ooh. Apparently I'm a little slow, though. I rolled a 7 in total.
Okay. Vigus is laughing too hard to actually make a coherent attack. Yeah. Oh, man. Okay.
Can Abby use a fast action to keep on cutting the cage, or does she need a slow?
It doesn't matter.
All right. Either. She'll do 3 more damage to the cage.
Okay, so you have it open now, so you could pull him out, you know, when you get the next chance, but you have an opening there.
Okay.
Fringe, would you like to keep attacking the house since the ogre is helping you now?
I think that is the plan, yes. Another 18? Oh, come on, baby. 8 damage. Although it's starting to rack it up now. It's 24 points that she's sunk into it.
Yeah. Yep. That house. It's there's definitely another arrow in that house. It solidly put an arrow in the house.
Yeah, Beth's feeling it.
Okay. So that is that turn. The ogre has this look on his face like, oh. So go to slow turns for the next turn. Or fast turns, I mean. Who would like to take a fast turn?
I still have like 2 more turns before I can actually
take a fast turn.
Take fast turns.
I know Kane's just going to own this guy eventually.
Ooh, that looks good. Jay, I think you're muted.
Yeah, there we go. 26.
Nice. You were just waiting for the perfect strike. Those were all just feints. That's
right.
Lots of them.
So it's 3d6 plus 2.
All right.
So 11.
All right.
That's a stabby.
So you finally just unleash hell on this guy, and so you're using a sword, correct?
Yes.
How do you finish off this ogre?
Nice.
I'll just chop off one of his legs.
Okay. So you finally finish slipping on all of the elf bits, and you get your bearing, and you like pivot around and swing the sword at his leg and take it off at his hip, and blood sprays everywhere, and the ogre falls over.
Jeez, it took me a while.
As soon as he sees that, Vigdis just starts screaming something out in Trollish, and the only word you can make out is Kane. He's supposed to be celebrating you.
So Abigail, would you like to take a fast turn?
No, she wants to take a slow turn.
Okay.
Now that he can again, Widow's Cry is totally gonna take a fast turn.
Okay.
And he's going to inside the open, like through the open window, cast drunkenness. So a sphere with a 2-yard radius centered on a point in the middle of the house. Magical fumes spread throughout it, then disperse. Each living creature in the area must make a success on a strength challenge roll or become intoxicated.
Oh,
while intoxicated, you're impaired, take half damage from all sources, and cannot gain insanity.
Well, that's why they call it liquid courage, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I just figured the witches would be way easier to talk to if they're drunk.
All right, so yes, you bomb them with drunkenness. All right.
Wow.
So that is the fast turns. Who would like to take a slow turn?
Vigdis would. And is everyone sort of attacking this house right now?
I guess. It seems
take
like
that that's fucking house down.
So Vigdis is going along with it. And again, he's screaming a bunch of words out in Trollish, and the only word you can make out is Kane. I rolled a 9 to hit.
A 9 just barely misses the house because it is mobile because it's got
legs.
Yeah, I think I slipped on a bit of elf. Semi-digested elf.
It's the dancing house of Baba Yaga.
Yeah.
Man. So who is Fringe going to keep attacking the house?
Which Fringe is going to keep attacking the house?
Since Fringe started the effort of attacking the house.
I rolled a third 18 in a row.
There really needs to be a path for attacking houses.
I got a 10.
It's the There's same one for attacking windmills and gazebos.
Oh, man. So, yeah, the house takes yet more damage as another arrow thunks into the house.
To the side.
What would Abigail like to do?
Number one, I need to assess the bishop. Is he still babbling to himself? Is he impaired? Is his leg broken?
Nothing seems to be broken. He's got some weird cuts and burns across him.
Okay.
But he's not really answering you, but he seems like if you led him somewhere, he would walk that direction and he's not like overly slowed.
Okay. So I would like to do two things just to be completely safe on this one.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to cast cure to remove one insanity from him in case he's insane.
Okay.
And then I would like to lead him towards the cart.
Okay. All right. So you make him slightly more sensible, and you start leading him over towards the cart. So you're moving basically from the clearing over to the edge of the woods.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Slow turn. Let's see. The elf threw drunkenness in the window. Vigdis attacked it directly. So the first thing that happens is the house Vigdis does an 18 hit you.
18 just does, yeah.
Okay. So what the leg actually does, it doesn't do any damage, but it just like stomps down on you.
The house retaliates.
The house always wins.
What you will have to do now is you can attempt a strength check on your turn to wrest yourself free from under it, but otherwise you are immobilized by the leg.
Hell yeah, I'll do a strength check. First you'll yell out, Abby, house is cheating.
So on this turn yet, it's still, you know, the house is standing on you. And the front door opens, and you see this person. They have long, long gray, like matted hair that's been like, it looks like it's in braids, but it looks like it's in braids that hasn't been, you know, brushed out for like years, and they fall down past her waist. She's got like this, it's like red and black, and it looks like it was a nice silk dress at one point in time, but it looks like it hasn't been, you know, kept up for years and years, so it's tattered and frayed in places. And she has all of these She has all these various rings on her fingers, and all of the rings look either like bones or skulls, or and they have like jewels for eyes and things like that on her fingers. And she's got really not nice nails, more like gnarly nails. Like she doesn't bother dealing with them once in a while, and they're almost claw-like. And she's got this really crazy expression on her face. And you don't know whether it's because the elf spell worked or if she just has a crazy expression on her face. And she walks out and she looks at you and she goes, "Welcome to the Screaming Forest. My name is Anise. I would just like to thank you for providing me with some entertainment by fighting my ogre."
I think from Vigdis's angle, he thinks the house is talking.
Yeah, Vigdis probably does think the house is talking at this point. But what I'm going to ask now is we can drop back into initiative if you would like to attack Anise. But right now, Anise is just kind of parlaying with you, so we're going to drop out of initiative. So anybody that wants to act or say things, you can do so.
Vigdis just wants to try and free himself is all.
Yeah, so as long as you're not attacking, if you're just trying to push it off, yeah, you can make your strength check to try and roll out from under it.
I will not be yeah, attacking, was... but I will spend an action to steal her identity.
Okay.
Does a 23 do the job?
Yes. So you wiggle out okay. from the skeletal bird foot that's standing on top of you.
So he staggers out from underneath it, and then he sees this girl and is kind of confused.
Yeah.
So my sister was not amused with the elves, so she had our servants do this to them. But I was kind of amused with what you did with the ogre, so I am willing to give you this. And she pulls out a scroll, and she goes, "But not willing to give you all of this." And she rips the scroll in half.
Oh, God.
And she throws it off of the porch of the house.
Okay.
Would you like to ask anything or bargain or perhaps attack my house further? Because we could continue doing that. That would be amusing. But right now, I think I've had enough amusement for the day, and I might teeter into annoyance if we go much further.
Vigdis sort of takes a position with his shield out near where Kane is, and he mutters to him, "Be careful. The house cheats."
Everybody cheats, Vigdis.
He nods as if it's like sage wisdom.
Yeah, that seems like, yes, that is the kind of good advice I come to Kane for. Yeah.
That's going to be up there with you can't buy a part of the ocean.
I would like to offer you a slightly damaged older human in exchange for some information. He's still perfectly good for all sorts of experiments or artwork. I appreciated what? Your art on the way in.
What in the...
And elves always seem to do the same, try the same trick twice.
I will also very casually go up and pull all my crossbow bolts out of the house. I'm not going to make eye contact.
If you're not in the mood for human, then I will... simply go and retrieve my piercing from your pet ogre and be on my way.
So she thinks to herself for a minute. She goes, "Well, it was actually Bishola that was making the deal. I'm not sure I'm in the market for an older human. I mean, I could always use the soul, but unless you have a way to distill and keep the soul, I'm not really sure that an older human is what I'm looking for. I still have enough test subjects at the moment that I'm not really sure he's that valuable to me. I don't really know what Priscilla had in mind there."
"What can you tell us of the troll spell?" Kane will ask, pointing his sword at her.
"What can you pay me that would be worth having me tell you about the troll spell, other than the boon that I've already given you?" And she motions over to the scroll that's ripped in half over there.
And, Abby will retrieve the scroll once she secures the priest and then go retrieve her arrow.
Has anyone mentioned that he's a bishop? I can't remember if anyone has said bishop in front of
the I don't know elf. If anyone has told the widow's cry that it's a bishop.
I
can offer you this compass.
your people didn't fill you in a whole lot. They were just sort of like, hey, we're doing a thing. Come with us. Because you're elves, and, you know, sometimes you do that.
Yep.
I did. I said I'll offer her the compass.
Now, what use is this particular compass?
Well, if you put Kool-Aid in it, you can find anyone you're looking for.
So, give me a will challenge roll here to see if this piques her interest enough.
I'm so good at those. Oh, a 12.
Oh, I see. So if you put blood in the reservoir, if you have blood from someone, then you'll be able to track them wherever they're at. I can see where that would be useful. I wonder if you could use it any other body parts to track someone. Maybe a bone fragment. Ooh, that would definitely be worth experimenting with. Ooh, this is a delightful toy. Thank you. So I will deign to tell you about what the troll spell actually is, since you don't seem to know. The troll spell was created by some of the most ancient of the troll race to gain final victory over their horrible enemies, the elves. And they decided that if the entire world were destroyed, but they caused it to be destroyed, then they could say that they won. So they enacted this massive ritual that essentially every time a part of the civilized world falls. So in other words, if a part of the world falls from being civilized into barbarism, it creates a magical magical charge that is stored underneath the normal boundaries of reality. So all of this magical energy is building up just beneath the surface of reality until finally there's enough to power the spell, and a hole is ripped open, and the entire universe is sucked into the void and destroyed. And then the trolls win!
Trolls have always been dumb.
Can you disperse this at all?
There have been so many societies that have fallen at this point. There is an immense amount of power that is underlying reality at this point in time.
Yeah, but can we do anything about it?
Read the scroll!
Oh, okay.
You just set up bookmobile programs for kids.
Yeah.
They're civilizing this world.
Does she give us the rest of the scroll or no?
No. She does not give you the rest of the scroll. But
what would you be interested in exchange for the other half of the scroll?
Unfortunately, I can't bargain any further. I'm late for a thing that my sisters are planning.
A tea party, perhaps?
Well, and she goes on to explain what they're going to do with their tribe of ogres that may or may not actually involve using a similar spell to what you used on this ogre. And at this point, all of you feel very uncomfortable the more details she goes into.
Abby already feels dirty from having to cast that spell.
I think Vegas wants to point out the dangers of drinking and driving your house.
It's okay. The house drives itself. And she like pads it. And the house like curtsies.
Well, thank you for your time. The elf will dismount and go reclaim his arrow from the now squishier parts of the ogre.
And then when you say that, she's like, thank you for being courteous. Courteousness is next to me not killing Eunice.
That is truly the way it is for the elves as well.
So, yes, unless someone launches any more attacks on the house, it starts lumbering off into the forest.
I'm tempted to, but...
If Fringe had done that, Abby probably actually would have tried to kill Fringe.
I know what I'm going to do. I'm going... Or no, wait. It has to understand my language. I'm going to try to subterfuge the house just to see if I can.
Okay.
No. Abby's going to start running.
It won't hurt it. It's not going to get hurt by this.
So what exactly...
You understand that this thing is much more powerful than all of us?
It just makes it charmed to me is all.
Oh, okay.
For one round. I assume it has a higher intellect than 11, though, so probably not.
Yeah. But the house would have really liked you for a minute, even though you shot it with crossbow.
But I look like its master now, so. Yeah.
So it lumbers back off into the forest, and the house is now gone. Is anyone that has any kind of magical talent going to look at the scroll?
Sure.
Does anyone have any magical talent?
Because it was dark, dirty trolls that did it, so we got to figure out what they did.
So basically, at the very end of the thing, there's a thing that's scrawled in, like, you know, crazy handwriting that basically says, "Before the troll spell is completed, you will be begging to complete this ritual for him." And that's actually written in a language. If you're illiterate, you can read that.
Okay. I couldn't hear what you said, though.
It says, "Before the troll spell is completed, you will be begging him to complete this ritual."
Okay.
And anyone that makes their intellect challenge roll, if they have some magical talent.
Indeed.
I do not.
Okay.
Yeah,
so,
1 to 3, not it.
So Widow's Cry understands it, and that's it?
That would be 11.
Okay, so what this seems to be part of a ritual for redirecting all of that underlying energy that's been building up because of the troll spell to Diabolus, who is the Lord of Hell.
Awesome.
So you could defuse the troll spell just by shunting all of the energy to Diabolus.
But then he would be more powerful.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, sure. He'd have, like, several centuries worth of societal energy from societies rising and falling. But, yeah. Other than that.
But on the other hand, the elves tied to him anyway, yeah?
What's that?
But the elves tied to him anyway, yeah?
Uh-huh.
So if we give them this, then we may not have to do that for a while.
Paying your soul debt ahead of time?
That's a heck of a soul debt.
Listen, guys, I got to get going, though, because it's just past 11 right now.
Yeah, I was just going to do a quick wrap-up. You guys will get, if you guys come back, I'm not going to make you guys see if you got lost or anything. Mother Bastion is going to... she'll pay all of you, so you all get 5 gold. Shortly after you guys get back into town, because since we're going to another tier, we're going to jump another year, but the following events happen. There is a huge riot in the city after you guys get back into town. Mother Bastion's home is burned down, and she is disfigured because of rules that are trying to declare that she is a follower of Diabolus and she must be purged. The church officials have not officially turned on her, but she was injured in this attack. The riots go on for weeks until the court wizard of the of Prince Horus brings out his newly declared son, who is going to be taking over the day-to-day administration of Tyr, and it is Sorigus. Sorigus enforces martial law. They bring in a bunch of mercenaries that are loyal to him. Any parts of the city that were rioting are pacified. And by pacified, it means the mercenaries ride through and decrease the population rapidly. After all of this happens, the town is relatively peaceful. Like, you don't like his new mercenaries keeping an eye on everyone, but after the initial purges happen, the town settles down quite a bit. And then we will skip forward the year from there. And I hope everyone enjoyed this session. And I'll catch up with you guys in the community. Everyone watching, if you're watching this online, I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you got something from it. And I just wanted to thank everybody. Thank everybody for playing. Thank everybody for watching. And I'm going to sign off now. Thanks, everybody, once again.
Jared, thanks for running.
Thanks for running. Thanks for putting up with me, everybody.
Hey guys, right. Have a great week.
Yeah.
Yep.